You're watching ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week.
Boise, Idaho is well known for its spectacular views of the Boise foothills and the rivers that snake through the terrain. It's also known for the blue turf, distinctly Boise to fans everywhere. And as the fans of Ohio University and Utah State eagerly await their matchup on that blue turf, we'd be remiss not to point out the other thing Boise is known for. The famous Idaho Potato Bowl is next. And it is the famous Idaho Potato Bowl. We're here in Boise on the campus of Boise State University, Broncos Stadium, the site for our matchup here this afternoon. Out of the MAC Conference, the Ohio Bobcats against the Aggies of Utah State from the WAC. And hi, everyone. Dave Fleming along with Mike Bellotti, former Oregon coach and athletic director. Mike, we've got Ohio and Utah State, and I know you really like this matchup for us today.
I do. We've got two very motivated teams with a lot to play for. Ohio looking for their first 10-win season since 1968, first bowl win ever. And then Utah State trying to get their first bowl win since 1994.
So a lot on the line for both of these teams, and we should see a lot of offense here today on both sides. Ohio scored more points than they ever have in their football history. And for the Bobcats, Mike, it really starts with their sophomore quarterback, Tyler Tettleton.
He's a great fit for their no-huddle offense. They decided to go no-huddle. He only set 12 single-season records this year. He can beat you, according to the coaches, with his arm, his feet, and his mind. And the other thing, he's a tremendous leader. He not only does it on the field, but works very hard in the weight room in the offseason.
So a hard worker, a leader for the Bobcats. I think you could say the same thing, Mike, about one of the linebackers for Utah State, one of the guys who will have the task of slowing down Tettleton and that Ohio offense, and that's Bobby Wagner, one of the best in the business.
Bobby Wagner has 140 tackles this year, third year in a row, over 100 tackles. They ask him to move up to the line of scrimmage to get more after the quarterbacks. He does it by getting more tackles for loss and more sacks this year, has really good speed, and I think is going to be a great pro at the next level.
So Wagner, a pro prospect on the defensive side for the Aggies, an NFL prospect for sure on the offensive side, is the tailback Robert Turbin, who's had one of the best years running the football in all of college football.
Coming off an ACL injury last year, nobody knew what to expect. He just put this team on his back. He's got all kinds of record. Offensive player of the year in the conference. He's got speed. He's got power. He's an all-around back because he can block, he can catch the ball, and he can run with power and speed.
So Turbin, who's head coach Gary Anderson, a big fan of Robert Turbin, his star tailback. Gary Anderson standing by right now along the sideline with our partner Heather Cox.
Dave, thanks so much. Coach, what does it mean to you to be coaching Robert Turbin in what could be his last game at Utah State?
It's a tremendous opportunity as a coach to be able to deal with a young man like Robert. And, you know, on and off the field, what he brings to the table every single day is special.
With this bowl appearance, you guys are making history. Describe the pulse of this team as the players get set to play in their first ever bowl game.
Excitement's the understatement of the world for these kids. It's been a tremendous week. They've worked so hard for 3 years now to get to this point, to take the next step as a program, and to be in a bowl game is very special.
Coach, enjoy every minute of it. Thanks.
All right, Heather, thank you very much. And indeed, Mike, really, for both of these programs, Gary Anderson's done such a great job for Utah State, taking them from a very low point to here in this bowl appearance. You could say the same about Ohio. This has been about their most successful stretch in their football history, and Frank Solich has a lot to do with it.
They're both very well coached. These guys came in, and these programs were not quite at rock bottom, but pretty close, and they've made them competitive. They're in bowl games. They're playing for conference championships. What more can you ask?
So, as we get ready for the opening kickoff of the famous Idaho Potato Bowl, Ohio won the toss. They defer, so the Bobcats will get the ball to start the second half. Utah State will receive. And the opening kickoff, we are underway on the blue turf in Boise. And the kick return, the up man, Chris Harris, to the 25 and across the 25. Tackled there as we set the starting lineups. First four. The Aggies of Utah State on offense. Robert Turbin, we talked about him. Their big play wide receiver is really the senior Matt Austin. For the Aggies up front, an experienced offensive line, but the youngest player, Tyler Larson, sophomore, an all-WAC first team performer. He is outstanding along the front for Utah State. And the Aggies quarterback, who's done a great job down the stretch. Utah State comes in having won five games in a row. The junior from Northern California, Adam Kennedy, out of the shotgun for the first play from scrimmage. And it's an option kind of play. Kennedy with a nice gain outside of the 30.
And Kennedy is playing at a level. His quarterback rating is 180, which would be third in the nation if he played enough games. But the real key is running this zone read, which he does so well. He did this in junior college. Not the best athlete, not the fastest, but efficient in running this offense.
A real big kid who got 7 yards on the first play for Utah State. He's got Turbin alongside, and Kennedy will throw his first pass. That quick hitter for a short gain. In fact, a loss. Well defensed by Ohio.
That's a great job by the Ohio defense. You've got to stop those jailbreak screens on the outside before they get started. Both of these teams are no-huddle, but they differ a little bit. Utah State being no-huddle, but they're going to shift and motion and do a lot of things. On the other side, you've got Ohio that just is pedal to the metal. Interesting about the quarterback situation at Utah State. We'll talk more about that later.
Chucky Keaton, the true freshman who started the year as the starter, got hurt and has not gotten his job back. On third down, they keep the ball on the ground. And Kerwin Williams gets the first down for the Aggies. Well, Utah State with its first down here in the famous Idaho Potato Bowl.
Yeah, Chucky Keaton was the starter from game one all the way till Hawaii, where he sustained a neck injury, scared everybody, probably more than anything else. He is healthy, he's been cleared to play, but Adam Kennedy's been doing so great, you can't take him off the field.
This time it's Michael Smith in the backfield alongside Kennedy. We focused on Turbin, but they have three running backs who are all very productive, and Smith keeps this one up the middle. Spins forward for some extra yardage. Noah Keller with the tackle.
They really do. It's a three-pronged attack. Turbin is the guy who leads it, though, the biggest ground gainer. But Smith is probably the best combination of speed and power. And then Kerwin Williams is a speed guy that also doubles as a return man.
So there's Turbin back in. The WAC Offensive Player of the Year. Record-setting career for the Aggies. Another one of those quick passes to the right flat and a move upfield by Eric Motes, tackled short of the first down.
Omar Lefwich, the corner, beat the block on the outside. That's very crucial. Those wide screens are just long handoffs that, again, you have to defend before they get started.
That's a big part of this up-tempo offense on third down. Quick tempo there. Turbin gets the first down, running over right side. A gain of 3, maybe even 4 yards on third and short.
We've talked about the quickness and the power of Robert Turbin. He's also very adept at getting in the end zone. He's tied for 5th in the nation in scoring. It's an amazing deal.
So another first down for the Aggies, averaging almost 35 points per game. Utah State, especially lately, they have been high-powered on offense. Turbin shuffles into the backfield with Kennedy. Back to pass on first down. That slant right into a tight opening, complete to Stanley Morrison.
Stanley Morrison, maybe the best all-around player. He can run it, he can catch it, and he can throw it. He is their Wildcat quarterback, just a triple threat option out there at wide receiver.
I don't know that there's another player in big-time college football who's listed generously at 150 pounds. Stanley Morrison is not big.
That might be in pads, by the way.
Yeah, 145 is what his coaches guessed to us. Second and short here after the 9.5-yard gain. And the Aggies are in Ohio territory on their first drive of this game. Just over 3 minutes in, Utah State with the ball. Travis Van Leeuwen came in motion. A handoff and a pitch play. Here is Morrison, who can throw. And he's going deep, in fact, underthrown, but the completion inside the 10 to Van Leeuwen. From the wide receiver, Stanley Morrison, with the flag down. But the trick play for Utah State works.
And we talked to the coaches yesterday. They said, don't be surprised to see Stanley throw the ball early. We've got a couple of flea flickers dialed up. Here you see it. Comes one way, the reverse toss back.
Penalty decline.
The throw up in the air. The ball is underthrown, which actually helps the receiver because he saw it. The DB held him. Play waved off. They'll take that completion right there. Great concentration on the ball.
So the pass interference against Josh Kristoff, the safety, waved off. 32-yard gain, and it's first and goal for Utah State, trying to get the first points of this famous Idaho Potato Bowl. Turbin, who's a touchdown machine, gets 4 yards to about the 5. Noah Keller with another tackle. He's their leading tackler, the senior middle linebacker for the Bobcats.
One of the other things that Utah State does very well is they score touchdowns 79% of the time in the red zone. That is a great percentage, because you don't want to just score field goals. When you get down there, you want touchdowns.
And a big difference between two good offenses, Utah State much more efficient in this part of the field. They're going to hand it. No, a fake. Kennedy keeps it. And that was read well by the Ohio defense. Curtis Myers with the tackle to set up third and goal.
And the best thing that the Ohio defense does is keep people out. That 22 points per game was second in their conference for the best scoring defense.
11th play of this drive coming up, and it's a crucial one. Third and goal from just outside the five, and Robert Turbin, the player of the year offensively in the WAC, is not out there for this one.
Coach Dave Baldwin said he calls plays. He doesn't call for players.
So any of their backs can run any of their plays. It's Smith alongside Kennedy, who's in the shotgun on third and goal. Looking to the end zone, nowhere to throw the ball, keeping it. Kennedy hit hard, drives forward, and comes up short. He got down to about the one, but it's fourth down, and early in this game, a decision for Gary Anderson of the Aggies.
That was great protection, great coverage, and a great scramble by the quarterback to set up the fourth and one at the goal line. This is why you play bowl games. This is why you play college football.
Now, Utah State, they hardly ever kick field goals, and we're seeing that again here. They're going for it on fourth and goal. And Turbin is in as the tailback now with a fullback in front of him. I formation on fourth and goal. They'll give it to Turbin. Turbin stopped, fighting forward, extra effort, trying to get there, and the officials say no. Noah Keller led the way with the tackle. And the Bobcats hold at the goal line. Utah State comes up empty.
First momentum change in favor of Ohio.
So Turbin so good at getting into the end zone, but not this time on fourth and goal.
See the push right there? Here it is. Now, can Ohio get out of the hole?
We'll see coming up when we return. The Depot Tower here in Boise, Idaho, the famous Idaho Potato Bowl. An exciting start to this one. Scoreless after a goal line stand for the Bobcats defense. Turbin denied at the goal line, and so now Ohio's offense and their sophomore quarterback Tyler Tettleton on the field for the first time at about the half-yard line. Tettleton just trying for a little more cushion. Gets forward to about the 3.5.
We talked about how efficient he is as a quarterback. He can beat you with his arm, his legs, his mind, because he's the one operating the offense. And LaVon Brazill has just checked into the game. We wondered about that. He's starting out there at wide receiver.
By far and away their best weapon on offense, Brazill, number 7. Not 100%, but he's given it a try here today in what will be his final college game. From that pistol formation on 2nd and 7, play clock still with 6 seconds. A little pitch play to Dante Harden, who gets hit hard and driven to the ground for no gain.
They're not going to allow a lot of time here. This is a huge play, though. You want to get a first down down here just so that you don't have to punt from your own end zone.
Frank Solich looking on, knows it's a dangerous part of the field for his Bobcats offense. 3rd and 8 inside the 5. Tettleton looking to pass, and he loses the ball. And he'll just dive out of the back of the end zone for a safety.
We talked about what a dangerous part of the field that was, because if you don't get a first down, the other team's going to get great field position. Here they're going to get points and field position. You can see the ball just slips out. It's probably a little cooler than he's used to right now. Ball slips out. He wisely decides to get it out of there because it allows them, rather than get tackled in or lose the football, now they can kick it away. They give up 2 points, probably the lesser evil.
So a mistake, but then a smart play to avoid the touchdown for the Utah State defense. And Tettleton, the first safety that Utah State has recorded all season long, the first 2 points of this game for the Aggies.
The problem for Ohio is they had established so much momentum with that fourth down stop. They've lost that now, put points on the board for the other team. And in addition, Utah State is going to get the ball in great field position coming off this punt or kick from the 20-yard line.
And Mike, part of the calculus, Utah State went for it on fourth and goal from the one is, even if we don't get it, we put the other offense in a very tough spot.
You're absolutely right. It's okay to leave it inside the one-yard line. It's, a lot of good things can happen for a defense when you pin the offense down that far.
So Gary Anderson disappointed his offense did not come through, but his defense gets him 2 points. Well, Capital One Bowl Week continues Tuesday on ESPN. Florida International takes on the Marshall Thundering Herd in a Beef O'Brady's Bowl, St. Petersburg. Capital One Bowl Week on ESPN, ESPN Radio, ESPN 3, also streaming live on WatchESPN.com. Tettleton, after losing that ball and going out of the back of the end zone for 2 points for the Aggies, they're going to use Ohio Will. It's punter Paul Hershey to kick the ball to Williams and Jacobs, who are back deep to receive for Utah State.
And that's fairly typical on safeties.
And it's a shank punt off the side of his foot. It takes a good bounce as far as Ohio's concerned, but not a great result. The flag is thrown as it bounces out of bounds. So we'll wait for the penalty ruling.
Coach Solich had told me the inconsistency of Paul Hershey has really got him worried. He 42 of his 48 punts have either been fair caught or down inside the 20, but he really doesn't kick a lot that are returnable. In this case, very bad result.
Now the head referee, part of this SEC officiating crew, and wagers.
Kick out of bounds on the kicking team. 5-yard penalty from the spot where the ball went out of bounds. First down.
Utah State will get the ball back. Let's check in again with Heather Cox. Heather?
Guys, you just saw the ball slip out of Tyler Tettleton's hands for a safety. Frank Solich immediately came up to him when he got to the sideline, and Tyler said, "Hey, my hands were slippery." Then Tettleton went to the equipment chest and took out a stick and rubbed on a stickum-type substance on that right hand. Also used a towel quite a bit to try and keep those hands nice and dry.
So we'll definitely pay attention to that. And Mike, you mentioned the cold temperatures. It is very cool. It's also very dry here in Boise.
Well, and I think the quarterback probably had worked himself up into a lather, probably was perspiring. The ball may have come back the center. You know, I don't think that's going to be a problem. He'll dry it off and dry his hands and maybe put some talc powder or whatever the case may be. But obviously possession of the football and handling it is essential for both of these offenses.
Beautiful day in Idaho. Utah State, great field position after the kick, right at midfield. And the Aggies with Adam Kennedy at quarterback, trying to move the ball for a second consecutive time. Kennedy looks downfield, avoids the pressure, and completes the pass. Morrison down to the 30 of Ohio for a gain of 20 yards.
That's a perfect Adam Kennedy play. He's laid back, he's easygoing, he's cool under pressure. He buys time in the pocket, and his decision-making down the stretch is the reason Utah State has won 5 consecutive games.
And a great start for the junior quarterback. Took over for the Aggies in their comeback victory against Hawaii, the turning point of Utah State's season. A handoff to Turbin up the middle. And Robert Turbin, a gain of almost 10 on first down.
If anybody's wondering real quick on what Tettleton rubbed on his hands, that is legal. It's a legal substance that can help dry out the hands, so there was no problem with that.
Tettleton, who fumbled the snap, really not the snap, as he went back to pass out of the end zone for the safety. Now Utah State trying to make that mistake really hurt with the ball back for the Aggies on offense. Kennedy, another quick throw right side with a block and stumbling forward, Jacobs.
Chuck Jacobs is their fastest receiver. He's the guy they really want to get the ball to on that wide screen look, because he can really fly. Ohio doing a great job. They didn't stop the first down, but they limited the damage on that play.
Jacobs checks out here for this first down play. Michael Smith is in as the tailback now for the Aggies. Already over 100 yards of total offense in this first quarter. The flag's thrown before that play started.
Ball start, 79 on the offense, 25 yards.
set the starting lineups for the Ohio Bobcats. They've been on the field a lot already in this first quarter. Tremaine Scott, probably their best pass rusher up front. The linebackers, we've already mentioned his name several times. Noah Keller, four-year starter for Ohio. And a banged-up defensive backfield. Jared Moore, though, the junior, he's getting healthy, and he's been playing well lately. First and 15 for Utah State. Smith again in the backfield. And a handoff is to Michael Smith, the senior. Tackled by Keller for a gain of 3, maybe 4 yards back near the original line of scrimmage.
Keller also one of those linebackers that has 3 100-plus tackle seasons under his belt. Going to take his game to the next level. Captain, he has played beat up the entire year. Had some hamstring problems, shoulder problems, but he's just a warrior. Always on the field, always around the ball.
Huge difference in the offensive production already. First quarter of the Famous Idaho Potato Bowl in Boise. Safety for the Aggies. And now looking for more offense here, more points. Inside the 20 of Ohio. Smith takes a handoff and is drilled and tackled by Tremaine Scott, the standout along that Ohio defensive line.
This is a great job. He comes out of nowhere here, just loops and just launches himself. He didn't launch himself, he launched the running back.
Robert Turbin comes back in now for Utah State. On third down, 2 of 3 on third down so far in this one for the Aggies. This, though, third and long. Kennedy back to pass, looking middle, and he throws it behind his receiver, and that pass is intercepted. Gerald Moore comes up with it inside the 5-yard line and gets the turnover for the Ohio defense.
Ball thrown behind, as you can tell. And I'm not sure that's going to be a catch. They're probably going to take a look at that because it looked like it may have bounced slightly off the turf.
Well, they will be looking at it. Great effort by Gerald Moore.
The further review, ruling on the field is an interception.
So they'll take a look, and we'll come back with a big ruling when we return here to Boise.
After further review, the ruling on the field is an incomplete pass. It'll be fourth down, 11 yards on the 18-yard line.
So obviously a big ruling, an interception nullified, Mike.
And you can see why. Right there the ball is tipped and it hits the ground. The DB, Gerald Moore, does a great job of gathering it in and trying to say, hey, I got it. But no, it was the film showed it did bounce and touch the ground.
So Utah State will have a chance to line up for a field goal here. Josh Thompson, who has attempted only 9 field goals all season long, has a long of 43 yards. Kicking game inconsistent for the Aggies this year.
And the other, they haven't had to use him because they've scored so many touchdowns in the red zone. So it's a combination of probably a little bit of lack of confidence and really a lack of use.
So they have to reset the chains. They have the ball spotted in the proper place on the 18-yard line. But they'll wait to get the chain set. Mike, you and I talked about Utah State so good in the red zone at scoring touchdowns, but here they are 2 trips already in this first quarter, and they have not gotten in the end zone.
The Ohio defense has done a great job, in my opinion, of shutting down the run. That's their strength. They have not been a good football team against the pass, 9th in their league this year.
35-yard try from the right hash, and the kick is on the way. And that is well executed by Josh Thompson. It's good. And an unusual score, Utah State takes a 5-0 lead, although there is a flag down on that field goal try.
It's an interesting place for a flag on a kick. It could be the number of people on the field, or somebody may have struck the center before he got his position. We'll have to wait and see what this is about. The center has the ability to snap the ball, and they allow a moment of time.
It's against Ohio.
Ooh, this will be take the points off the board because it should be a first down, 15 yards.
Looked to me like
personal
it was
foul.
An illegal hands to the face foul. Gary Anderson wants those yards and a chance to get a touchdown.
Personal foul, number 99 on the defense. Penalty will be half the distance to the goal. First down.
A big penalty for Curtis Myers. And that gives Utah State the first down and a first and goal situation.
And typically you're trying to strike and drive the offensive lineman back and up so you get your hands up into the air. It doesn't happen that often, but you can understand how that might, trying to get through the lineman up to block your hand in the air.
Utah State takes those 3 points off the board. They're looking for six here with Gary Anderson, very aggressive coach. He's already gone for it on fourth and goal from the one in this game and did not get it. Now first and goal from about the nine. Turbin and Smith are both in. Kennedy fakes a handoff, a little option play, keeps it. And Keller leading away for another Ohio tackle. Kennedy gets to the six.
Okay, I think we see something on the left side of the line, maybe right in here, coming in. And just keep an eye on it. Watch it the last minute. Hard to tell.
I think that offensive lineman for Utah State had his helmet pushed off there with the hand that went right up toward that helmet. I think that's where the penalty came. See if Utah State can take advantage. Now second and goal. Having a hard time in this part of the field, the Aggies. Another option play. Turbin takes a pitch. Robert Turbin with a big hit is shoved out of bounds. Inside the five, down near the two, Gerald Moore put the hit on that time.
It's a good thing the sideline was there, because I don't think you stop Robert Turbin. That one tackle, Gerald Moore hit him pretty good. Didn't seem to faze him. He's like a Mack truck down there.
Huge, powerful, 216-pound tailback who has 23 total touchdowns on the year.
The real question to me is this two-down territory. They're already taking 3 points off the board.
Now, that would be an interesting decision. We'll see. It's third and goal. Turbin alone in the backfield. And Kennedy, a rare time under center, fakes a handoff. Looking for the end zone. Caught. Touchdown. Terran Lloyd, the tight end. And the penalty, a huge one against Ohio. The Aggies take advantage and get that touchdown on the board.
Terran Lloyd is a big, big target. 6'7", 258 pounds. Great play fake away from him that allowed him to sneak out. You can see the play fake inside to Turbin. That's going to attract a lot of attention. He sneaks out the backside. Hard to find him. You got to keep your eyes right on defense when you're down there. Very difficult from inside the 3-yard line with play action.
Extra point is up and good. So a safety plus a touchdown. And a first quarter dominated by the Aggies of Utah State so far. As the Aggies take the lead here. The great outdoors here in Boise. Beautiful day for football. 9-0 Utah State.
College football, the famous Idaho Potato Bowl, is brought to you by the Idaho Potato Commission, Dove Men Plus Care, and Vonage. Sounds good.
Here in Boise for the famous Idaho Potato Bowl, Utah State has dominated this one, a 9-0 lead with a safety and a touchdown from their big tight end. Lloyd getting hugs from his teammates. A little holiday spirit, perhaps, Mike, with the streak of red in his hair.
I think that might be a bowl game do right there. I don't know. Or maybe has that year-round. I don't know. What do you think?
Could be. We'll find out. Jacob Howder, the kickoff man for the Aggies. Have a low, short kick. And Dante Harden, good kick return man, brings it up. Gets upended. And Utah State thinks the ball popped out there. Ohio, though, they'll keep possession and have the football. The Bobcats offense will come back on the field outside their own 25-yard line.
Oh, upended. That guy came in from the side, and the ball is definitely, it's not out because he had possession as he hit the ground, but it is very, they will talk to the coaches will talk to him on the sideline about making sure that ball is tucked high and tight.
Ball carrier is down.
Well, sounds to me like they're going to look at this upstairs again.
Yeah, they were very emphatic. The officials on the field called him down. Now, that's the call on the field. They'll take a look upstairs and to see that.
Which is important because the video evidence has to be enough to overturn the call on the field. They'll take a look at it as we step aside Obviously, big moment for Ohio coming up when we come back. Well, as we guess, the call on the field stood, so no fumble for Dante Harden. And just barely hanging on as he went to the ground, down before the ball squirted out. So the Bobcats, who've hardly had possession in this first quarter at all, get the ball. Tettleton pressured, keeps the play alive, and finds Harden up the field for a nice game. Outside the 45-yard line, the best play for Ohio so far in this one.
And that's exactly what Tettleton can do. He can get out and beat you with his feet or his arm or his mind, because this is a great choice. Here he's moving to his right. He keeps a passing posture, keeps his eyes downfield, finds Harden, who's a great all-purpose back, only 183 pounds, but really a good receiver out of the backfield.
And he took a big hit there and was shaky getting up with that flag thrown.
Personal foul. Illegal helmet contact. 15 yards from the end of the run, number 36 on the defense.
That's the reason. It's the reason why Harden is shaken up. That helmet-to-helmet contact called against McCade Brady.
And that's a huge safety issue this year. You know, that's difficult because the receiver actually put his head down too, and that's the difficulty for defensive players now, both at this level and the NFL. I'm not sure how you legislate that.
I think the officials would say that they're just going to call that penalty. If the helmet-to-helmet contact is there, it's going to be a flag. And it was, even if Brady would have had a hard time avoiding it. So the penalty after the 20-yard gain, Harden has to come out. Bo Blankenship is in as the Bobcats tailback. And they'll have to burn a timeout, disorganized timeout. As the play clock was
Ohio,
running down.
First timeout of the half, 30-second timeout.
And, Mike, you might say that Ohio just has not been able to build up any kind of rhythm on offense because they haven't had any snaps. This first quarter has been dominated by Utah State holding the ball on offense.
Right, and it's unusual, but they've really only run this offense for 1 year. They saw this. Troy University ran this against them in the bowl game last year. They were so impressed with it. Coach Solich and his staff said, we need to go to that offense. So they've run it for, 12, 13 games now. There's still some kinks to be worked out. Tyler Tettleton, only a sophomore, doesn't have a vast amount of experience in this offense either, but they have been so efficient this year and so dangerous. Over 500 yards in three of their last five games. Ranked number 21 in the nation in total offense. It's just, they just have to get untracked a little bit.
Well, a guy they really need, their standout wide receiver, LaVon Brazill, banged up. Let's go down to Heather for an update on Brazill.
Well, guys, as a reminder, Brazill is playing with a torn meniscus in his left knee. He hasn't practiced all week, hasn't been much of a factor in this game so far. He's wearing a sleeve. Now, the medical team told me that it's the pain and the swelling, not instability. More in a minute.
Hand off on first down for no gain to Bo Blankenship. Heather?
Well, there was so much concern about whether or not LaVon Brazill would actually be able to be effective. It's his senior year. He wanted to do everything he could to play. As I mentioned, pain and swelling are the issue. Stability is not, but he is going to have surgery next week with hopes to be in the NFL Combine later in a few months.
He's not on the field right here. Ohio goes deep in the pass. Along the sideline is ruled incomplete, but a penalty flag is thrown. The receiver, Phil Bates, a converted quarterback who was apparently juggling the ball, he's arguing that he made that catch.
That'll be close. There, it was a pass interference penalty. Both were joshing. Here's the catch itself. Problem is he is, it's going to be close. He's got to have control. It bounces there down to his hip. I don't think he's got control. I think he hits down out of bounds. I think that's what the call is going to be. Working on Nevin Lawson there probably for the penalty. But Bates is the guy that they said, if LaVon Brazill could not play, then they were going to go to Bates.
And, Mike, the penalty is against Bates. It's offensive pass interference.
Number five on the offense. Penalty 15 yards. Back down.
So it didn't matter whether he had possession or not. Apparently he pushed off.
As I said, they were both pushing, both hand-checking, and most of the time that goes against the defense, not always. You see right there, the initial, they both push. It's just, I think Bates was a little bit stronger.
So the 15-yard penalty against the Ohio offense back into their own territory, and the pass is a little high behind the intended target, falls incomplete. Third down and very long coming up.
One of the things that Ohio's coaches were worried about was the physicality of the DBs for Utah State. They said they might be the most physical group and play more man-to-man than anybody had seen so far.
Heather was telling us about the pain and swelling for the standout wide receiver, really the best receiver to ever play football at Ohio, LaVon Brazill. He is in. At the bottom of your screen, number 7 on third down and long for Ohio. Final 2.5 minutes of this first quarter of the Famous Idaho Potato Bowl in Boise. Pressure coming, and Tettleton's pass falls incomplete. He took a big hit from Boje Filimoyatu, and the pass is incomplete. Ohio's going to have to punt the ball away.
We talk a lot about on third and long, the defensive line now can just come after you. They bring a backer late. It confuses the Ohio group in terms of their protection pickups.
Intentional grounding on the offense. Penalty will be lost down at the spot of the foul. Fourth down.
So it was already fourth and long. Now it's fourth and forever. Well, essentially say the sack should have happened on the intentional grounding, the loss of the yardage, plus it stays fourth down.
Remember, if he's in the pocket, he has to throw it to an eligible receiver. He's out of the pocket, it has to cross the line of scrimmage.
Fourth and 37, Paul Hershey, the punter, with Morrison back, signaling fair catch, comes up and takes it at about the 26-yard line. Utah State's offense has been real productive in this first quarter, and an offense with some first-team WAC performers, Mike.
Well, Robert Turbin, he was the offensive player of the year in the conference. Bobby Wagner, we talked about, just an all-star linebacker, makes things happen. And the offense is 6th-ranked rushing team in the nation because of Tyler Larson and Philip Napalu. Napalu not playing today due to injury.
Yeah, their offensive line is a little banged up. It's been healthy most of the year. But Utah State hadn't really been hurt by that in this first quarter. They've moved the ball very nicely on offense. Kennedy under center, and Turbin with a nice hole. Robert Turbin spins through that tackle and gets 7 or 8 yards on first down.
And this play is the basis of the Utah State offense. It's power O, pull the off guard, off tackle power, get people moving north and south, let Turbin run following Funaki Asisi going through the hole.
Second and short. A quick tempo, no huddle offense on both sides. Much more effective for Utah State so far. Jacobs came in motion, and they'll hit Jacobs out of the left flat, turning it upfield. Gets the first down, short of the 40-yard line. Omar Leftwich with the tackle.
One of the difficulties in Baldwin there, you see the offensive coordinator for Utah State. Utah State will get on the ball, then they'll move, then they'll shift, then they'll motion, and they're no huddle, so it takes the defensive coordinator somewhat out of the game. The Ohio defense has to recognize and react, see things, and make the adjustments on the field.
They do have their middle linebacker, Noah Keller, who is a nice quarterback for the Ohio defense out there to help make those calls, but a lot of pressure on that defense. Well defensed here, nowhere to go for Turbin. He lost a yard or two.
I think Turbin should have turned that one up. He actually wanted to get the bigger play by going outside and probably should have just got up and tried to get back to the line of scrimmage.
And for a guy who, with Keller, the quarterback, so to speak, for the Ohio defense, looking to his sideline, Turbin, a guy who's piled up such big numbers, he comes out for this snap. He does get a lot of rest. That depth at running back for Utah State allows Robert Turbin to stay fresh. Van Leeuwen leaves the backfield on 2nd and 12. Kennedy, a little screen kind of action. But again, good defense by the Bobcats. They saw that one coming all the way.
Yeah, Josh Kristoff, the safety, snuffed that out. He came up. It did not allow the lineman to get there. There's a point at which the initial blocks on the outside free the receiver. Then the line has to get to the second level. If they don't, the safety can make the play.
3rd and 13 for Utah State, and they're not going to get a playoff here. They're just going to let the first quarter come to an end. Perhaps Ohio starting to settle in a little bit on defense, but it's a first quarter that's been dominated by the Aggies. Utah State leads Ohio 9-0.
The world.
Well, beautiful scene for the famous Idaho Potato Bowl here in Boise as the sun starts to set and the temperatures will be dropping on a clear but cool December day in Boise. Utah State with a 9-0 lead, start of the second quarter. Dave Fleming, Mike Bilotti with you. The Aggies, though, at the beginning of the quarter with a third down and 13 coming up. Adam Kennedy, their quarterback, from the shotgun set with plenty of time but nowhere to throw the ball. Finally gets rid of it and tipped up, almost intercepted. It falls incomplete, and we'll see a Utah State punt coming up.
That was their 30 defense, which there's only three linemen up front, and actually two of the outside guys are linebackers, but they dropped eight. They had five under three deep zone, very difficult, great for coverage, tough to find holes in that type of zone defense.
Good point. Kennedy had all kinds of time, but just could not find a place to go with the ball. So the first punt here for Tyler Bennett, who had a pretty good year punting the ball for Utah State. And Dante Harden, who is back in for the Bobcats, takes the punt. And trying to get a block to the left side. It's not Harden. Here comes a penalty flag. It's Travis Carey, who's back there to return the punt. And he gets it across the 30 to the 31. But that flag thrown after a 44-yard punt and a 10-yard return that could be coming back.
And that 44 matches his average, actually, on the year. He's very good, number 11 in the nation, punting the football.
Both coaches waiting for the call from the head referee, talking things over with his crew. Same SEC crew that was with Utah State at Auburn, their opening game of the year, where the Aggies almost pulled off an all-time upset against the defending national champion, Auburn Tigers. Just coincidence.
Illegal block, back, number 10 on the receiving team. 10-yard penalty, first down.
So the penalty against Ohio as they get the ball back, and we check our storylines of this game so far. Early second quarter brought to you by K Jewelers. Utah State with a safety, second play from scrimmage for Ohio. Then a personal foul penalty against the Bobcats on a made field goal. Utah State took the points off the board, took the penalty, and got into the end zone. The Aggies with a 9-0 lead. But Harden is back in. Heather Cox told us they did the concussion check on Harden, and he checked out okay. Harden back in. One of the key players for the Bobcats. There's Brazill getting the catch in the flat. Can't get through the tackle, though. Brought down for a loss. Tavares McMillan with a nice tackle there out in the open.
And Brazill is only one catch away now from the record single season for reception. He already holds it for receiving yards and touchdown catches in the season. I hope he gets it. I hope he can also do something with it. Not sure he's totally healthy.
Yeah, that catch got him negative 4 yards, so he went backwards on that one. Second and long, Tettleton, a little fake look to the right. He can move, throws against the grain. Great effort there, but an incomplete pass. His receiver jumping up to try to make that catch, Riley Dunlop, but out of bounds.
He had to throw that a little bit late, got pushed a little bit too far outside the pocket. No chance for Riley Dunlop to tap it. He had to be about 8 or 9 feet tall to tap his feet in bounds on that one.
Sloppy so far for the Ohio offense. Four penalties, only 3 total yards in this game. For an offense for Ohio that had more yards and more points than any in their history for a single season coming into this bowl game. Third and 13.
The physicality and the speed of Utah State is creating problems for Ohio.
And another penalty flag is thrown. They'll sort this one out. And apparently before the flag, there was a timeout recorded. That's what they're talking about here. I think Ohio from the sideline tried to call the timeout to prevent the penalty.
Timeout, Ohio University. Timeout was called prior to the delay of game. Therefore, disregard the flag.
So well explained there. Ohio trying to get something going. They trail the Aggies of Utah State 9-0. Well, usually you come to Boise in December, and those Boise foothills are blanketed with snow, but it's been so dry here in Idaho. Perfect weather for a football game, the famous Idaho Potato Bowl, 9-0. Utah State leads Ohio. The Bobcats offense has done basically nothing so far in this game. Tettleton on the move. Nice pass complete to Dunlop, and just enough for an important first down for the Bobcats.
Great job of Tettleton seeing the field, buying some time, sprinting out to his right. It's a pocket pass. You see that they pin the outside defender in so he can get outside, and the timing of the route works out very well for him to throw the ball to Dunlap for the first down.
So Tyler Tettleton, the sophomore quarterback who broke almost every single season passing record in Ohio history, has a chance to break every career record as well. He's got two more years of football for the Bobcats. With the first down pass, and now a handoff to Harden up the middle. Dante Harden gets a nice gain of 7 yards on first down.
And that's the pistol right there. That's the zone read from the pistol. You see it. It gives the back a chance to get velocity going towards the line of scrimmage. You can run more downhill than some of the other traditional spread offenses.
So that's what Mike's talking about, that pistol formation. The quarterback in the shotgun and the running back behind him still. Pitch play, Tettleton. A pretty good timing there, and Harden got it upfield with a penalty flag thrown in late. Kyle Gallagher helped out on the tackle. Close but short of a first down. We'll see what the call is.
One of the things you see, the versatility of the pistol also, because they can attack straight ahead. You can run the option either way. They say that having the tailback in the eye makes it difficult. I think... Oh, yeah, absolutely. If you saw that, you saw
after
both
the play,
of them.
Unsportsmanlike, number 3 white, number 1 blue, penalty, offset, third down.
They traded punches there, and that was a good job by the officials to see all of it. Sometimes it's usually the last guy or the second guy that gets penalized.
Yeah, the second guy was Nevin Lawson, the defensive back for Utah State. If he just had not retaliated, that would have been a big penalty against Ohio. Instead, it's third down and 1 coming up. And Bo Blankenship, the tailback in for Ohio, in that pistol formation. And a little short pitch, Blankenship upfield. And he gets the first down. Our yellow line there was not lined up with the first down marker. That was clearly enough for the first down. The carry by Blankenship for 5 yards.
Trying to get the ball on the outside. They have struggled to run up inside, so get the ball on the edge quickly with the little quick toss, which is a unique play that's come back now in college football.
First down, Ohio. This is their best drive so far in this game already. And Blankenship coming left side. Gets hit right around midfield, but does get 6 yards on the carry. Capital One Bowl Week continues Wednesday on ESPN. TCU with their great rushing attack against the tough run defense of Louisiana Tech. It's the San Diego County Credit Union Poinsettia Bowl. Capital One Bowl Week on ESPN, ESPN Radio, ESPN3, and also streaming live on WatchESPN.com. Tettleton in the pocket will be sacked. Back behind the original line of scrimmage, he goes down. 7-yard loss on the play. Big play for the Aggies defense.
Quinn Garner, one of their best pure pass rushers, just comes off the edge, beats the tackle. As you can see, very difficult. Had to hold the ball just a little bit too long. You have that clock that goes off in your head as a quarterback when you feel like, I've got to get rid of the ball.
So from second and relatively short, third and long for Ohio. They need to get into Utah State territory here. They are 2 of 4 on third down so far. Tettleton looking left, completes the pass, but well short of the first down. Caught there by Jerry Gross. So Tettleton, that had no chance really to get the first down. When we're finished here in Boise, the Arnell Carriers New Orleans Bowl, featuring San Diego State and Louisiana Lafayette, the Raging Cajuns, 9 Eastern right here on ESPN.
See if you can watch Ronnie Hillman goes. That consecutive 1,500-yard rushing seasons for San Diego State.
Well, we're seeing one of the best running backs in the country here in Robert Turbin. And Hillman is certainly one of those as well for San Diego State. The punt by Hershey will bounce and take a good Ohio kick inside the 10 and be down right around the 8-yard line. So poor field position for Utah State, but they have the lead 9-0 when we come back.
College football, the famous Idaho Potato Bowl, is brought to you by the Idaho Potato Commission. and the Lexus December to Remember sales event for a limited time at your Lexus dealer.
Well, a couple of the activities they had leading up to this Famous Idaho Potato Bowl, some bowling competition, a go-kart race between the two teams. Dave Fleming, Mike Bellotti here in Boise. Mike, a big part of coming to a bowl game is the kids get a chance not only to play football, but have a little fun.
The bowl experience, it's got to have those kind of things to it. That's what the kids will remember in addition to the game.
The potato looking on as the Utah State offense takes over inside their own 10. First and 10 Aggies with that 9-0 lead. Turbin alone in the backfield. And he'll get the handoff. Right side, made one man miss and gets forward to about the 10. I think he was upset thinking a bigger game was there. Another tackle for Noah Keller and the Ohio defense.
Keller, one of the better defenses, better defensive linebackers, according to Turbin, that he saw all year on film. He just makes a ton of plays, is always around the football, and tough to beat in the open field.
Well, we've said his name a lot in the first quarter, plus about 5 minutes. Kennedy back in the more typical shotgun formation for the Utah State offense. Out of the shotgun, he'll give the ball again to Turbin. He pushes forward near the 15-yard line, a gain of almost five. Corey Hastings with the tackle to set up third down.
You know, talking about activities at bowl games, the coaches were a little happy there wasn't snow because typically they go tobogganing or on the tubing or whatever, and there's a little bit of potential for injury. So the go-karts are bowling, no potential for injury. Coaches are happy, players are happy.
Yeah, the ski season is on hold here in Boise. They have had no snow. It's been so dry. So the tubing was taken out. But the players we talked to did have a lot of fun leading into this game. Third down and three for the Aggies. Morrison in motion, and they'll give it to Morrison on a fly sweep kind of play. Nice move by Morrison to cut it upfield and get the first down.
Fly sweep is a great play in that situation. You only got 3 or 4 yards to go because the speed at which the guy takes the ball, he's already moving at full speed, and the defense has to try to react to that in a very short period of time. Great job. He just does a nice job of putting his foot in the ground there, you see it, and getting upfield to get that key first down.
All 145 pounds, Stanley Morrison gets the 4 yards they needed. Now Michael Smith in to the left side of the quarterback, Adam Kennedy. Kennedy gives the ball to Smith with no running room whatsoever. And we'll say it again, Noah Keller leads the way with the tackle.
Noah Keller kept leverage on that play. Leverage means you keep your inside shoulder on the ball to the sideline. He gave the running back absolutely nowhere to go.
Keller does not come out of the game, basically, for Ohio. They don't even list a backup on their depth chart for him. Helping get his teammates lined up there for this second and 10 play. Out of the shotgun, ooh, the handoff to Williams. But again, well defense by Ohio.
There were some collisions there. I think Keith Moore came off the edge, and he took out some blockers. That was a huge collision. I heard all the way up here in the box. You see it's coming off that outside there. There's going to be a boom right there. He said, I'm just going to take out the blockers. You guys make the tackle. And, of course, Keller's in on the tackle.
He got some help, but he was the guy who put the initial hit on Kerwin Williams. An Ohio player is down along the near sideline, and I think that's Gerald Moore, who's taken a knee. Seems to be okay, but a pause here before the third down play.
Both coaches talked about both of these teams are very well coached. They're very physical, and they run the ball. They want to establish the run, and so there's going to be a few heads bumping out there today.
Well, the Ohio defense, I'll give them credit, Mike, because early in the game they could not stop Utah State, and these last couple of series for the Aggies, the Bobcats really have settled down.
Sometimes it just takes seeing it and getting used to the pace at which they do things and sort of making sure that you communicate for a defense to all be on the same page.
Third and long for the Aggies. Lloyd, the tight end, shifts over to the left side where he's really an extra pass blocker most of the time. But he has the one touchdown catch for Utah State. Out of the shotgun. Kennedy with all kinds of time. Flushed out. He's going to go deep. And his man out there is Morrison, but the pass is well short and incomplete.
Great job in pass protection. He could have had forever, but there was that was even a better job in coverage down the field. No receiver could find a way to get open.
Dave Baldwin, the offensive coordinator for Utah State, with a quick word for his quarterback as he came to the sideline. Still chatting there. Second consecutive punt for the Aggies. Tyler Bennett back out there, and Travis Carey once again deep to receive. A low punt, and Carey's got a chance for a return, but he bobbles the ball and has to pounce on it. That could have been some real yardage for the Bobcats. Instead, they'll take over at about their own 44-yard line. 9-0, Utah State with the lead. Well, it's the famous Idaho Potato Bowl, so of course we need the great big Idaho potato truck, 28 feet long, 11 and a half feet tall, celebrating the Idaho Potato Commission's 75th anniversary coming up this upcoming year. We're in Boise, and the Bobcats have the ball. Play fake, Tettleton with the completion to Brazill. So his second catch there, just short of the first down.
And that will tie him now for the single season record for receptions in a year. One more, he breaks that record. He needs two touchdown receptions to lead all-time career TD receptions.
Now that's his 68th catch of the year. He's already set the single-season records for yards and touchdowns this season. Hand off to Blankenship, and he'll get the first down for Ohio. Let's check in again with Heather Cox. Heather?
Well, guys, Ohio's wide receiver coach Dwayne Dixon just gathered his group preaching, stop trying so hard, just play, don't stress, can't force it. I promise that will happen. Now, one of those receivers, Phil Bates, did hurt his right knee, so now two receivers not 100%, certainly hurting this offense that's already struggling.
Blankenship getting the ball quite a bit in this first half, a gain of 5 yards on first down. A good block from his tight end, Mike Jordan Thompson.
One of the keys is to get some positive momentum. They're running the ball, mixing up the run and pass right now, doing a great job. That's what they need to create some rhythm for the offense.
Good decision there by Tyler Tettleton to keep it, and he gets near the first down, short by about a half a yard.
They need some type of a score on this drive to make it a one-possession ball game. They're still really in this, despite not having the ball a lot, not doing much on offense. They're only 9 points down.
Well, they were really dominated in the first quarter. The second quarter's been a different story, and the Bobcats look like a much more confident team right now. Third and short, Tettleton keeping it and needs an extra surge, but I think he does get the first down. Needed just a yard. He got a yard and a half there.
That's their version of the quarterback sneak. They just do it. He runs straight ahead from the shotgun. That is not good if Al Lapuahu is off the field. He's sort of the key inside for that Utah defense. He's their nose guard, the big guy up front.
They have some depth there, but he's the starter on the bench and clearly in pain. Blankenship gets the handoff. Seeing some power football now from Ohio, moving the ball on the ground. 5 more yards for the Bobcats.
One of the ways to settle down and get in rhythm is try to run the ball more effectively, more efficiently. The best way to do that is go north and south.
Bobcats at the Utah State 26 for second down and 5. Tettleton in the pocket, throws down the sideline, caught, and reaching for the pylon. It's a touchdown. Derek Roback, the tight end. Beautifully done, and the first points of the game for Ohio.
Great execution on this throw. He's open from the get-go, does a nice job, and he's got the ball out there, keeps his foot inbounds, and breaks the plane. Nice job. Nice job of finishing the play.
Excellent effort from the second string tight end, Derek Roback. Just his sixth catch of the year, but that one into the end zone. The extra point is up and good. And so Ohio, they have turned this game around in the second quarter. A 2-point lead for Utah State, 9-7. But the Bobcats, the team that's rolling right now. Roback gets into the end zone. The first points for Ohio. And his quarterback, Tyler Tettleton, pleased with that effort. Set Seventh play drive for Ohio. Tyler Tettleton throws a touchdown pass to his tight end, and the Bobcats have their first 7 points of this Famous Idaho Potato Bowl. A game that has really turned around dramatically in the second quarter. 9-7, Utah State with the lead. Chuck Jacobs deep to receive for the Aggies. Matt Weller, excellent place kicker for Ohio. Kicks this one high and short. Jacobs sprinting forward, catches it already outside the 20. Maybe decent field position for the Aggies as their offense comes back on the field. Well, Dave Fleming, Mike Bellotti, happy to have you with us here from Boise. And Mike, really, the game started off and everything was going wrong for Ohio. Penalties, turnovers, a safety. But the Bobcats have done a nice job in the second quarter to settle down.
It always going Utah State's way. The safeties you talked about, the penalty set up, the touchdown. But Ohio, give them credit. They've regained their composure, regained the momentum in this game. And all these bowl games are momentum driven.
Moving the ball on offense, and their defense has been much better here in the last few series, slowing this powerful offense down. Handoff and a good run for Michael Smith up the gut across the 40-yard line. 8 yards on that carry. Good field position to start here for the Aggies after the short kickoff.
One of the things you see both of these teams do, when they get in trouble or when they sense they're losing momentum, they go back to a physical nature to run the football, to try to establish dominance at the line of scrimmage.
Second down and 2. Kennedy, like a stretch run to Turbin coming left. And he could not get those 2 yards. No gain. Let's get a quick check in our studio with Wendy Nix. Wendy?
Thank you, and we get a check on college hoops. The number one team in the nation, Syracuse, on the road at NC State on ESPN2. C.J. Williams, the long two, and NC State with the lead 23-15 early in this ballgame.
All right, here we are in Boise, 3rd and 1 for the Aggies offense. 4 for 8 on third down so far in this first half. Kennedy with a pitch play left, and Smith gets the first down and more into Ohio territory, down to about the 47-yard line for 13 yards.
The development of Adam Kennedy as an option quarterback, and he's not the most, 6'5", 220 pounds, but great choice, great decision-making on the pitch, got the ball out quick, got the necessary yardage.
Kennedy under center here, and quick tempo for the Aggies. Hand off Turbin, straight ahead running. Nice, powerful running from Turbin to get the extra yards after contact. Nothing's been easy for their star tailback.
No, they've held him fairly in check today. He's had to work very hard for his yards. And he's not the back to take on the fly sweep to the outside. He's the back to attack inside the tackle box with power.
Got 5 yards there. Noah Keller, the leader on that Ohio defense, comes out of the game and was very unhappy about it as he came to the Bobcats sideline. He's had a huge first half from his middle linebacker spot. No fly sweep, instead just the give to Turbin, and again falling forward, Robert Turbin, right near that first down mark. Jermaine Scott with the tackle for Ohio.
And I like this. I like a power running game, pound them, try to take the clock and the ball down the field.
They're going to stop the clock and perhaps to bring the chains out to measure and see if it is a Utah State first down.
And did you notice Utah State was already going to be on the ball? They wanted to run a quick play on a third down in case it was third and short.
So they'll look at it. But Mike's right, Utah State was, they didn't really care about the measurement. They were ready to go.
Well, and they've got, you know, 2:41 left in the half. They want to take this, ideally, in a perfect world for Utah State, they would take him down the field and then have no time left. And Keller tapping himself out.
Well, Keller was upset about something there, but what a first half, Mike, for the middle linebacker.
Well, they're running in his neck of the woods. Everywhere is his neck of the woods. I mean, here he is, put a hat on a hat, wherever he goes, he's getting through blockers, in on the tackle, inside, outside, just roaming all over and back in the game already.
So that didn't take long. Keller comes back and he's got 8 tackles here. Quickly to the line after the measurement said Utah State was short, but the officials hold up play. That quick snap. And there's Williams squirting through. First down, still going. Kerwin Williams inside the 25 on third and short with a big gain.
And that's what Williams does. He's not the biggest back. In fact, he's the smallest one they have, but he is so quick through the hole.
And how about this hurry-up tempo? Kennedy again, right back to Williams. This time, though, there was the Ohio defense, and Noah Keller there to meet him.
Noah Keller's just a warrior. I mean, the guy, I don't know if he had an equipment problem, maybe needed a sip of water. I mean, he's gotten so much work in already in one half of football.
A guy who almost never comes out. He's going to be double-digit tackles here before halftime for Ohio. Utah State's offense, though, getting it going again. Van Leeuwen leaves the backfield. Kennedy throws, and that was an errant pass attempt, trying to get it to Matt Austin, incomplete.
That play actually had a chance, and he thrown that ball a little softer, but he got a little excited, put a little bit too much on it. You got to throw it so the guy does not cross the line of scrimmage, because it's a screen with people downfield to block.
Third down and 9 here for the Aggies, inside the 25. But not quite in that so-called red zone, and they spread it out with 5 different receiving targets here. Kennedy alone in the backfield in the shotgun. Final 2 minutes of the half. Adam Kennedy looking, throwing, and the tight end can't make the catch. Lloyd, the intended target, incomplete. And I think we'll see the field goal team come back on the field for Utah State.
And Lloyd is a big, we talked about him being 6'7". Got a guy hurt on the field here.
So for Ohio, on their
Corey
defensive
Hastings.
Side, Corey Hastings, a junior. Good pass rusher, so you see him in on those third down and long situations. And while they look at Corey Hastings, let's check in again with Wendy Nix.
Thank you very much. Coming up with the H&R Block Halftime Report, Temple and Wyoming kickoff. Bowl season, we'll have the highlights. We'll tell you about the best running back you've never heard of. And we'll preview Capital One Bowl Game, Bowl Week, as we get set for 35 bowl games from start to finish.
All right, thanks. Just the very beginning of bowl season here. Another injury, we heard about that from Heather, the wide receiver for Ohio. Banged up receiving corps. Phil Bates is limping toward the locker room. Ohio's lost some targets here. Josh Thompson, the place kicker, for a 39-yard attempt here. Trying to push it up to a 5-point lead. Thompson's kick is on the way, and he pushed it wide to the right. No good. So the field goal miss. Utah State moved the ball nicely on that drive, but comes up without a single point.
Very frustrating to move it that far and then miss a fairly short field goal. That would have put them a 5-point lead, which means that you're out of field goal range. Now it's still that close, just a safety away.
Well, this week on Monday Night Football, Frank Gore and the 49ers continue their postseason tune-up as they battle the Steelers. Excellent matchup. Steelers battling themselves for playoff position. Steelers 49ers on ESPN's Monday Night Football at 8:30 Eastern. Also available live on Watch ESPN. And coverage begins at 7 Eastern with Monday Night Countdown served by Applebee's. Chance here for a 2-minute kind of drive for Ohio. Coming off their first score of the game, they trail by 2. And Tettleton, their quarterback, with the pass out to Brazill, turning it upfield. LaVon Brazill for a gain on first down of 5 yards, tackle by Gallagher.
I believe that set the single season record for receptions in a year. But it's not, really, that's not as important as you talked about, this 2-minute drive. And this offense is built for the 2-minute no huddle.
Tettleton, 7-for-9, throwing the ball from that pistol. Will hand the ball off to Harden, and a play that does not get Ohio the first down. So the clock still rolls, and they've got a third down and short coming up. Bobby Wagner with the tackle. The leading tackler for Utah State. Garner also in on that play. Third down and 2 for Ohio. Final minute of the first half from Boise. Perhaps a lower scoring half than we anticipated in this one.
Using a lot of time. A lot of time.
Too much time. Tettleton takes that snap. The throw. Brazill with the catch, and he breaks the tackle to get the first down, then gets hit out of bounds. but stops the clock. A nice play by LaVon Brazill for Ohio.
Well, he's their big playmaker. He's their most explosive weapon. They need him. I think now he's loosened up. He's tapping his head like, I'm not trying to go again, get somebody else in there. But Bates has already walked off the field, so they're hurting at wide receiver.
So there is that school record, 70 catches now. Also the record in yards and touchdowns. A player is hurt for Utah State along the sideline.
I think it's the corner, Nevin Lawson.
So that will stop things here. 39 seconds to go. Ohio nearing midfield, but the injury timeout as they look at the cornerback, Nevin Lawson, who's really their best cover cornerback.
He is. He and Jumani Robertson, they like them both, but Ohio only having one timeout. They're in good field position. They can't afford, though, to let that much time run off the clock. I'm not sure that they really wanted to take that much time with the previous play.
So he's helped off. Gary Anderson, the fiery Utah State head coach, trying to help his defense come up with a stop here. Ohio has a chance, even if they could just get into field goal range. 3 points would give them the lead headed to the locker room. And Frank Solich has to be pleased with the way his team has rebounded after a nightmare beginning to this game.
And Matt Wheeler's already kicked 24 field goals on the season.
Their place kicker, Ohio, is the special teams player of the year in the MAC. Tettleton from the shotgun. Rolling right, looking for a block, gets out of bounds. That stops the clock. 34 seconds to go, but a short gain of just a couple of yards.
Yeah, and Wheeler's long is 49 yards in the season, so they've got to go 10 to 15 yards just to get into his range.
Not even yet at midfield for Ohio. They have one timeout remaining as well. Second and eight for Tyler Tettleton and his Bobcats offense. Swing pass, Harden with the catch, and a good open field tackle there by Terrence Alston into the game as a backup. Also, Sanders there helping out with that play.
Yeah, he had to take that. That was a great play because had he gotten through that, he would have either got the first down yardage or been able to duck and get out of bounds.
And Ohio uses its final timeout of the half with 22 seconds to go. Well, let's take a look at the Dove Men's Plus Care quarterback stats, Mike.
Well, it's really pretty close. Both are pretty efficient. They haven't run the ball a great deal. Probably the surprising thing is that Tettleton has negative yardage on the ground. They haven't been able to shake him loose yet, but certainly his resurgence or comeback, getting Ohio back in the game by finding some key people down the field, and you know, both have thrown for one touchdown.
So Tettleton and his Bobcats hoping for points at the end of the half. Ohio's had to travel a long way to get to Boise. Much closer trip for the Utah State Aggies. Adam Kennedy, their quarterback, on the bench. Driving distance for Utah State fans, just a little bit more than a couple hundred miles. Meanwhile, from Athens, Ohio, here to Boise, pretty long trip.
Yeah, that's a heck of a drive. Not sure I'd want to make that.
I don't think any Bobcats fans made the drive out here to Boise. Plenty got on an airplane. Ohio down by two. Final 23 seconds of this first half and a third down and six here to try to keep this drive going. Tettleton and Brazill had to jump up to try to catch it. Could not do it. It falls incomplete, and Utah State's defense does find a way to hold.
Yeah, tough. Just a little quick on the throw. Brazill couldn't quite get there, and I think he's kicking himself because he says, I should have had that.
And that would have stopped the clock on a first down, given Ohio a chance to set the offense, maybe run a play or two before bringing the field goal team out. Instead, Morrison back to return this punt from Paul Hershey. And Morrison just runs up to let it bounce inside the five and saved. No. Touchback, couldn't quite save it in. Good effort on special teams. Probably won't matter. The ball will be coming out to the 20 for the Aggies. With only 9 seconds to go, we'll see if Utah State tries to get anything going.
I would assume that they're going to just let this go. This is a great job because it's where the ball is. It's not where the man is. If the ball breaks the plane, it's a touchback, which it obviously did. I would assume Utah State will just take a knee here and get out of the half.
Quick start for the Aggies of Utah State. They have slowed down in the second quarter, and we've got a good game here. Final 9 seconds, and they do just go in the kneel down formation. So Adam Kennedy takes that knee, and both teams will regroup in the locker rooms For Tyler Tettleton and the Ohio Bobcats, they have to be pleased that they did not let the game get away. The first quarter was totally dominated by Utah State, and yet it's Ohio right in there, down by just two against Utah State and the Aggies. Heather Cox down with the Ohio head coach, Frank Solich. Heather?
Thank you. Coach, after just 18 yards in the first quarter, more movement in the second. How did you get more offensive rhythm?
Well, we started to mix the plays up a little bit more and started to get a little bit of a ground game and then build off of it with some passes that that were effective, picked up a couple crucial first downs.
Coach, before the game, you admitted that you were concerned your receivers would be challenged by Utah State's secondary. How do you put them in a position to have more success?
Well, they're running, mixing up their coverage as well, zone and man. But we're starting to get some routes now that I think we're effective with. You know, we had that last drop there, which would have kept us on the field. I feel okay with what we're doing offensively. We just need to execute a lot better. Frustrating first half for our guys. We just need to calm down.
Coach, thanks. We'll let you get to the locker room. Dave?
All right, thanks, Heather, and it seems like they have calmed down. We got a ball game. We expected one, and we've got one from the Famous Idaho Potato Bowl. It's halftime. The Aggies lead 9-7.
You're watching ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week.
It's the Famous Idaho Potato Bowl from Boise. And at the start of the second half, the Utah State Aggies hold the 9-7 lead against the Bobcats of Ohio. Dave Fleming, Mike Bilotti back with you. And Mike, you know, you and I both expected two very productive offenses during the regular season. We expected, I think, a more offensive-oriented first half than we got.
I think everybody's surprised right now. The offenses are being contained by the defenses. Oh, the defensive people read the papers, too. Noah Keller, Bobby Wagner, they want to get their guys going. They've done a great job of containing two very potent offensive attacks.
Start of the second half, and the Bobcats will be getting the ball, and they really controlled the second quarter. Ohio, a couple mistakes early in the game. A fumble that turned into a safety, a bad penalty that really helped Utah State get their only touchdown. But since those mistakes, the Bobcats have been the more successful team on both sides of the ball, and Ohio will have its offense on the field after this kickoff that begins the second half from Boise. The lights are on the blue turf, and the return, Ryan Clark, without much room at all, will be stuffed short of the 20-yard line. And as the second half gets going, let's check in with Heather Cox.
Dave, thanks so much. Gary Anderson out of the locker room said in order for his team to win, they can't have any turnovers. They also want to create a better pass rush. And he said, then we've got to make some big offensive plays when we're given the opportunity. Then kind of with a wink and a smile, he said, but don't be surprised if this game comes down to the last possession. He's expecting a close one, guys.
Well, both of these teams have a history of that this year. It's unbelievable how many games have come down to the last minute and been decided by a touchdown or less.
Well, it really is remarkable how many dramatic games these two teams have played. Tyler Tettleton, the quarterback for Ohio, finished the first half with a lot of momentum on offense. Tettleton with the ball first here. And that play clock expired. That's been a problem for the Bobcats before
time
it did.
Out. Ohio, first time out of the half.
They did have to burn a timeout before they even run a play in the second half. So that's a real mistake. It gives us a chance to take a look at the American Airlines first half stats. Mike, what stands out to you?
Well, if you look at the first quarter yards, Utah State had the ball almost the entire time. And after that, Ohio doubled them. I think the reality to me is there's no turnovers, very few penalties. It's been a pretty well-played game, but the defenses, in my mind, have really exerted their influence.
And the couple key mistakes, that one fumble that was recovered by Ohio, so it doesn't go down as a turnover, but it was 2 points for Utah State, the fumble in the end zone, and then that one penalty on the field goal try.
The key penalty there that gave them a chance. They took points off the board, but were rewarded with a touchdown to replace a field goal.
So in that first down, first drive of the game, Utah State went straight down the field, but on fourth and goal, Robert Turbin was stuffed, but then two plays later, Tettleton lost the ball in the end zone, smartly took the safety, but it was still 2 points, and here's that penalty we were talking about. The field goal was good, but the penalty gave Utah State a first down. They took the field goal off and got into the end zone. Now a big negative play, Tavares McMillan with the tackle in the backfield for Utah State.
The unforced error on the safety, you're right, was huge. This is a great way to start this half, though, for Utah State. They want to come and make a statement, be aggressive on defense, attack the offense.
a 7-yard loss on the pitch to Dante Harden. Is that a mostly quiet game? Out of that pistol, Tettleton on second and very long. Flushed out, throws. Caught, but a short gain out to the 11 of maybe 2 yards by Dante Foster.
Both coaches in the locker room or coming out of the locker room talk about this first series of the third quarter in a close game, a tight game. They really feel like they have to get off to a good start. You talk about your defense having to hold. Offense got to get move the ball down the field. Let's take it to them.
Well, Frank Solich can't be thrilled with those first couple of plays, plus already having to burn a timeout before they even ran a play in this third quarter. Third down at 15. Tettleton on an option, keeps it, and gets tackled after a gain of another couple of yards. Will Davis defended that one well, and Ohio immediately will have to punt.
You know, sometimes with young quarterbacks, you have to remind them where the 25 or 40-second clock is. I think sometimes if it's not in the same place, they don't naturally just see it. That may have led to some of these delay of game penalties or forcing Ohio to take timeouts.
Paul Hershey, the punter, out again for Ohio. Stanley Morrison back to receive. And a much better punt this time sends Morrison way back inside the 30. Trying to get to the outside, Morrison. Gets pushed out of bounds there. So an excellent punt and a very short return. 59-yard punt there. Well, last season, you may remember in women's basketball, one of the signature games of the year, Baylor and UConn. It came down to the wire. The top-ranked Huskies got a win. This season, Brittany Griner and Baylor have a chance for revenge. Sunday, 8:30. That's tomorrow. UConn and Baylor with those rankings reversed. Meanwhile, we're here in Boise. And it'll be the first possession for Utah State of the second half. The Aggies have a 9-7 lead. Adam Kennedy, the quarterback for Utah State, with Motes in motion. And a handoff up the middle with a nice hole. Turbin with the carry, and he tumbles forward and may well have the first down close. Robert Turbin trying to get it going here. Turbin was, I think, reasonably held in check in that first half.
No question. He had great patience on that play. Let the play develop. Let the fake by the quarterback actually move the defense, and he ran through a gaping hole.
Second and a half a yard. Turbin goes in motion, and they stick the ball right in the gut of the running back, Michael Smith. Out of the open, to the 20, to the 10, push, diving. And Smith gets in. Touchdown, Utah State, 63 yards.
Really close as to whether he stepped out of bounds at the very end of the run. But great effort to finish this play, and the defender tried to push him out of bounds. You see just great effort right there. Let's watch his left foot there. Great job. Tremendous job of keeping it in bounds. Looked to me it was in bounds the whole way. This is probably a better angle to see it right here. No, but I think he got in.
So the big play from the senior, Michael Smith, the point after attempt, is up and good. And Utah State with a great start to the second half, the long touchdown run. And the Aggies take the 16-7 lead. Well, what a start to the second half for the Utah State Aggies here in the Famous Idaho Potato Bowl. Michael Smith, the senior, one of the leaders for Utah State, with a big play on the ground. And the Aggies' touchdown makes it 16-7, their lead against Ohio.
And they talk about him being a quiet leader. Doesn't say much, but he's the guy at halftime that gets them together a fourth quarter. Watch for him. He'll say some things to fire up his team.
The guy has overcome some serious injuries and is still a major contributor despite those injuries for the Aggies. Low kickoff and taken deep by Harden inside the 5 to the 20. It gets licked as he gets to the 25. Good special teams tackle. Mike, what went right for Utah State on the big play on the ground for Smith?
Well, there's two things. There's great blocking up front to create the seam for Smith to get through, and then it's a key block. I'm going to go back for a second. Watch number 11, Stanley's Moore. Watch him there. He's not going to have, it's not a big physical place. Just be there when the ball carrier gets there and screen him off and allow Smith to get going.
So just as we expected, 145-pound Stanley Morrison leading the way with his blocking. But a nice job by Morrison. Harden on that kickoff return was dinged up, so he's on the sideline. Tettleton passing and fits it into Brazill across the 40 for a nice gain. First down, Ohio, 16 yards to LaVon Brazill. After the kickoff. That's one way to do it, right, Mike?
That is. I think that's a pretty well-trained dog. I want to take care of me for a while.
Now, let me just say, my dog would not be executing that play that well. Blankenship straight up the middle, right around midfield. So 9 more yards for Ohio.
You know, this has been a game of strike and response. Utah State extends a strike early. Ohio comes back with a great response.
He's not just the bowl game specialty T-Dog. He does that job for all the Broncos home games here in Boise. We're on the campus of Boise State. Bobby Wagner with a tackle there.
So they didn't bring their own dog in? They hired a local one to do that?
No, the Broncos dog, very comfortable here in Broncos Stadium. What do they call him?
I wonder if he could do it on a turf that wasn't colored blue.
Z. Z. That's his name.
Z.
And nicely done. First down, Ohio. From that pistol kind of formation, Tettleton fakes the handoff. Tettleton with room in front, so he'll keep it, and Tettleton can move. Nice run from the sophomore quarterback inside the 35 with the flag, and could be a face mask penalty at the end of that play. We'll see.
Utah State held him very well in check in the first half in terms of him running the ball. That was a great play action fake that allowed him to get outside.
14-yard scramble and
personal foul, wrestling the face mask. Number one on the defense. Penalty 15 yards, first down.
You see the fake initially sets up, pulls the defense, and then he goes outside, recognizes everybody's covered, and people are looking to coverage. They have their backs to the quarterback. That's when you can run and take off. I'm still not sure that should have been a penalty.
It might have been two different near face masks there. But with the penalty, Ohio inside the 20. Blankenship on the pitch. Bo Blankenship inside the 10 to about the 7-yard line for 9 yards on the ground.
When you have success, your offensive line gets fired up. When you get the big guys up front excited about football, you say run behind those guys and get up, get going, north and south.
First time Ohio's been inside the red zone in this game. Blankenship with a bobble there, and man, did he get hit hard. A loss on the play. Kyle Gallagher, the guy who with the big hit on Blankenship.
Let's watch this one just for a second. I want you to watch the back. Oh, my goodness. And that's a throwback. We talk about Kyle Gallagher, just a tough, classic middle linebacker. Just the big guy inside that loves to come up and lay the wood.
You see him wearing that cast on his left hand on that replay. And Gallagher, he broke his hand.
Broken bones don't mean anything. Come on.
He played an entire game with no cast on and a fully broken hand earlier this year. Has had the cast since then. Has not missed any time whatsoever.
That's a badge of courage for linebackers. Have a cast on somewhere.
Look at the play clock. Again, Ohio just too many times in this one.
Offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
And Tettleton is very upset not getting the call in from the sideline that he wanted. So the delay of game penalty. Ohio's acting like they got a timeout here.
I think they may have called a timeout from the sideline again before.
But I don't think the officials actually gave them the timeout. And they're going to run the play clock starting now.
They're going to get another problem. They have a problem already. They're down to 20 seconds. Yeah, I think they thought they called timeout.
Well, this is just mass confusion for the Bobcats. With a chance to put points on the board and answer the Utah State touchdown. Instead, Ohio having all kinds of trouble. Tettleton does get the playoff here. He throws for the end zone. His man fell down. No flag. Incomplete. Intended for LaVon Brazill.
And no surprise who you're going to go to down there. LaVon Brazill, most receptions, most TDs in a season. He's the guy. He's playing on a bad leg. And it looked like he's actually gotten stronger as the game's gone along.
Ohio moved the ball nicely there, but then some critical mistakes as they got into scoring position. So they'll lean on their place kicker, Matt Weller, as Mike mentioned. 24 made field goals this year, 56 in his career. From that left hash mark, Weller with the hold and the kick on the way. It is up and good. 32-yard attempt, and Ohio puts 3 points on the board. Third quarter action from Boise, Utah State with the 6-point lead.
college football, the Famous Idaho Potato Bowl is brought to you by Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. Nissan, proud partner of the Heisman Trophy. And Great Clips. Relax, you're at Great Clips.
An Ohio field goal has made this a six-point game. Utah State with the lead. Dave Fleming, Mike Bellotti with you. Mike, Utah State now 185 yards on the ground. And the Aggies lately especially have really been getting it done up front.
They have, and just a three-pronged attack, multiple running backs, and they're just trying to pound that middle.
Kickoff here for Ohio. The Bobcats did answer the Utah State touchdown with the field goal of their own. Now a loose ball. That's a live ball scooped up by Jacobs and finds a way to at least get out of the real danger zone across the 15 where the Aggies will take over on offense. Here's what we were talking about. That point of attack for Utah State up front.
Well, the point of attack is the middle of the line of scrimmage. And you look at them pounding in a variety of ways, getting it back through to the second level. But continue to pound, pound, pound. Be patient with the running. Something's got to open up, and eventually you get the big play out of it because you hit it and get to the next level, get a couple blocks, and then off to the races. Pound, point of attack, middle of the field.
Well, that big play from Michael Smith on the last Utah State drive. They have the ball back. Smith and Turbin both in the backfield with the quarterback Kennedy. Kennedy looking to pass, still trying to set it up, completes it. And that's going to lose at least a couple of yards there. Michael Smith with the catch.
To Michael Smith.
Michael Smith, the leader today, and they feel he's one of their most explosive running backs. Robert Turbin held relatively in check at 61 yards, and then Kerwin Williams really the speedster of the group, but just coming in as a changeup.
They have three different running backs who've got a lot of carries during the regular season for Utah State, and each of them averaged better than 6 yards a carry. So they're all playmakers. Man in motion, Travis Reynolds. Now the handoff, and there's a hole for Turbin, but tripped up, and a yardage-saving tackle there for Ohio. Turbin does get 6 yards, though. Kristoff, the man who tripped him up.
It's what we had talked about earlier. Robert Turbin can hurt a defense. He can pound and pound and pound and open up some seams, not only for himself, but for the next running back to come in.
Third and six for the Aggies across their own 20. Utah State's been good on third down in this game. Kennedy in the pocket, gets rid of it, and the pass is caught for a first down. Eric Motes with the reception. A Capital One Bowl week continuing Tuesday on ESPN. Florida International takes on Marshall. It's the Beef O'Brady's Bowl, St. Petersburg. Capital One Bowl week on ESPN, ESPN Radio, ESPN3, and also streaming live on WatchESPN.com. Michael Smith, the tailback. Kennedy under center after the first down. Utah State. Smith gets the carry right side. And Michael Smith, more good running to midfield. And dragging tacklers still not going down. Inside the 35, down to the 33.
We talked about the staple of their offense. And it is this power off tackle. You see the big guy there, pull lineman. Fanuki, I see the big block on the outside. And then just, not to be denied, do not go down. Pull guys with me. One guy's not going to take me to the ground.
Nathan Carpenter went along for the ride. Smith now well over 100 yards, 38 on that carry alone. Well, Michael Smith, he's been the man for Utah State. First down into Ohio territory. Off the play action. Kennedy all kinds of time. Throws one toward the goal line. And knocked down incomplete, intended for Chuck Jacobs.
Through the double coverage that time, Chuck Jacobs ran sort of a two-move out. He looks a little gimpy right now, like he fell, came down wrong. See him go up for the ball. It's just broken out, and whoa, he takes a bad spill right there. Well, a tough night for the receivers so far.
No kidding, on both sides. They'll hope that Jacobs is okay. Utah State might have gotten lucky there that pass was just incomplete. So second down and 10. The ball at the Ohio 33. Kennedy Pitch play. There's Williams. First down and more. Wrestled out of bounds by Keller. But inside the 20, down to the 18. 15 more yards on the ground for Utah State.
You could tell Ohio got sucked in on the dive play. And when they do that, when you see the quarterback come outside with only one defender and a pitch back, you know that they're in trouble. Here you can see right there, there's only one guy outside. Adam Kennedy, easy read for him. Got a blocker on the outside. They're lucky that didn't go further.
Well, Robert Turbin on that play was a nice decoy. Another first down for Utah State. Back inside the red zone, leading 16-10. Here's Turbin. Keller pushes him to the ground. 3-yard carry.
The other thing that Utah State likes to do is line up and make a defense protect all 8 gaps. So they're in a double tight look, which means that they have to account for all 8 gaps at the line of scrimmage, which really puts stresses a defense in terms of your run support.
Big difference in the total yardage in this game in favor of Utah State. They've got the ball on the move again. Two impressive drives so far in the second half for the Aggies. Out of the I formation, here's Smith. Smith gets to about the 11, wrestled down there by Corey Hastings. 5 more yards for Michael Smith to bring up third down and short.
And right now you sort of ask, why would you do anything but run the football? They're having great success running the football, either right or left, although they've primarily been to the right side during this drive. But they're having a great deal of success. Don't throw it, just run it.
Over 250 yards rushing as a team with still 6 minutes to go in the third quarter. Man in motion on third and 3. Hand off, and there's the first down, and another touchdown again is Michael Smith. 11 yards to the end zone, and the Aggies are taking this game over on the ground.
This is a great job. I can tell you what, up front, they do a tremendous job at the line of scrimmage. Once it breaks, there's nobody there. They get a hat on a hat for people at the point of attack. And Michael Smith is a hot back. He's saying, feed me. I want the football.
And they're giving it to him. Michael Smith, what a second half. Extra point is good. And Utah State has that 23-10 lead.
And Michael Smith just exploding on the scene. Utah State breaking away in this game.
Holiday season here in Boise, Idaho, and especially pretty over the botanical gardens. It's the famous Idaho Potato Bowl here, a big event in town. And the Ohio fans in the spirit, but hoping their team can pick it up, because that guy, Michael Smith for Utah State, has just been on fire here in the second half. He's got a new career high, 149 yards and 117 of them on 4 carries here in the second half.
It's almost 30 yards a carry. I think I'd keep giving him the football.
That will get it done. Here's Harden coming up to return the kick to the 25 and squirts through. Best return for Ohio out to about the 34-yard line. Let's go back to the studios with Wendy Nix.
Thank you. The number one hoops team in the land, Syracuse, on the road at NC State on ESPN2. Syracuse have pulled it away, but C.J. Leslie and company making it a ball game. Just 2 points separate Cuse and NC State. And elsewhere in the ACC, North Carolina having no problem with Appalachian State, 97-82, under 30 seconds to play.
But college football here in Boise, Ohio, now down 13. Harden out of the backfield with the catch. And Harden, nice effort to get out right toward that first down mark, about a yard short for Dante Harden.
Ohio's been pretty good tonight at responding to adversity. When they got behind early in the first half, they came back. Let's see if they can do it now.
And you'd figure, Mike, that the Bobcats are looking to hold on to the ball for a few minutes here. Their defense looks pretty beat up.
Has got to be tired, you're right, and Utah State's having their way now at the line of scrimmage.
Harden gets the carry, gets upended, but does get the first down. And let's go down to the sidelines to our broadcast partner, Heather Cox. Heather?
Well, talk about beat up. It's been a tough day so far for Ohio running back Dante Harden. In the first quarter, he took a hard hit to the head, tested for concussion, was cleared to play. Second quarter, injured his right wrist, got that taped up. Third quarter, injured his left knee, yet he's still in there. Now, guys, remember, Frank Solich told us he took 60 snaps in their last game. He needs to limit that. Now that he's hurt, he might not get as many carries, guys.
Well, good points, Heather. And they have worked Bo Blankenship in quite a bit in this game. His backup at the tailback position. Trying to get Harden going on the pitch to the right side. Harden gets to midfield. And an extra yard after that. 6-yard carry for the senior.
Yeah, I think people forget sometimes, and Harden's going to take himself out for a blow here, but running backs are going to get hit on every single play. They're carrying the ball, they're going to get tackled, or they're blocking for pass protection for somebody else. So there's a lot of contact for those running backs.
Saw the reminder, the RNL Carriers, New Orleans Bowl, when we're done at 9 Eastern on ESPN. Blankenship in and gets the carry on the pitch play. Gallagher with another tackle for Utah State, but a first down Bobcats.
As you said earlier, Ohio really needs this to keep their defense, let them rest and recover a little bit, get a drive down, get some points on the board, get this down to a one possession ball game again.
Well, they are into Aggies territory now. Final 4 minutes of the third quarter on the blue turf in Boise. Tettleton sort of faked that option, throwing deep down the middle. Brazill jumps up. And he caught it. What a play by LaVon Brazill. Touchdown, Ohio. 44 yards for the Bobcats.
Great job on this play. This is the option fake. It just really sucked up the defense. He had multiple receivers open down the field, took the longest throw, and his partner, LaVon Brazill, comes up and supports him. But I'll tell you what, this is a great job, great throw, and maybe even a better catch going up in traffic, securing that ball in the end zone.
That's why he's the best receiver who's ever played at Ohio. Extra point is good, and that's a good answer for the Bobcats after the Utah State touchdown. Now 23-17.
Great job. Once again, elevating, going up, and he's got a bad knee. To go up like that puts tremendous stress, but focus on the football. You can see his eyes, hands, strong hands. What a great catch, and then tucking that ball in to absorb the contact with the ground.
Well, Brazill, that's his 18th career receiving touchdown. Second most in school history. He has just about every other record as far as receiving goes in the history of Ohio. Capital One Bowl Week continues Wednesday on ESPN. TCU and their great rushing attack against the tough run defense of Louisiana Tech. It's the San Diego County Credit Union Poinsettia Bowl. Capital One Bowl Week on ESPN. Also on ESPN Radio, ESPN3, and streaming live on WatchESPN.com.
You know, you talk about great coaches. Gary Patterson at TCU is always mentioned nowadays. So what a tremendous job he's done there. You know, you never know about onside kicks. In a bowl game, anything is possible. And I think with this, the touchdown, they're one touchdown apart, I don't know that they would try something that dangerous.
The game felt like it was getting away from Ohio, and it doesn't feel like that any longer. After the impressive drive from Tyler Tettleton and his offense, and LaVon Brazill with a great play receiving. Kick return here for Jacobs and Utah State, and that one going nowhere, backwards in fact. We focused a lot on the Aggies running game, but Ronnie Hillman, Mike, of San Diego State, in the game that will follow us, great running back for the Aztecs.
He's one that not a lot of people know about, but he's had two consecutive 1,500-yard seasons. He's gained in the last two games 370 yards and scored 6 touchdowns, and he's also an all-purpose guy. He catches the ball out of the backfield, too.
Well, that will be when we're done here on ESPN. San Diego State and Louisiana Lafayette, 9 Eastern, the RNL Carriers, New Orleans Bowl.
So Robert. Now it's punch, counterpunch. You know, score, score. You got to keep scoring.
No kidding. Robert Turbin, the tailback, he'll try to deliver a punch here on 1st and 10 from the 15-yard line. That's where this drive begins. A fake to Turbin. Kennedy, nice job avoiding the pressure. And Kennedy's going to go down anyway. That'll go as a sack. He lost a yard. The pursuit from the Ohio defense.
He's shaken up a little bit too, but Kennedy, he's so cool. His ankle, uh-oh, this could be trouble. Chucky Keaton now. They have not played him. He's the guy that had the neck injury early in the season. Boy, we're going to drop him like flies here.
So Myers. Ohio. Kennedy, the quarterback for Utah State. Both are down on the blue turf. What Mike referenced, There's Keaton, the true freshman from Houston. You may well remember him. He had a great start to the year, his first ever college game down at Auburn. The season kicked off there, Mike, and he performed brilliantly as Utah State almost got the win.
Yeah, Kennedy, this shows how so cool under pressure, but here he just doesn't quite, and that ankle sort of gets cut, trapped underneath him, or his leg. Looks like it got shaken up, but he did walk off or sort of jog off the field on his own, and that's good news. Because Keaton is probably a more dangerous rusher, but not quite as accomplished a passer, although he can run the ball, and he presents a different dimension to the offense.
So Kennedy's going to come out. Heather Cox with a little bit more on the man who should be coming in, Chucky Keaton. Heather?
That's amazing. On the field before the game, there were rumors spreading like wildfire that Chucky Keaton would actually be starting tonight's game, to the point where three different coaches came up to me proactively to let me know that indeed it was Adam Kennedy that was Utah State's starter. Now, I did talk to Chucky Keaton before the game. He was extremely focused and assured me he's 100%. But remember, guys, he has not had any contact, has not been hit since that bruise to his spine back on November 5th at Hawaii.
I would guess that they're going to just have him hand the ball off, not put him in any kind of jeopardy. And then if Adam Kennedy is healthy, he can come back in the next play.
It was a very scary moment at Hawaii. And Keaton, this is his first snap since then, more than a month ago. A true freshman, very dynamic talent for the Aggies on second and 11. And he's going to run an option kind of play with a cutback and a good move. Keaton, well, how about that back to action? Nearly a first down run for the true freshman from Houston, Chucky Keaton.
Chucky is back. There he goes. I'll tell you what. They kept him in, and they let him run the ball. That was an option read, and I think he might have kept it on purpose, regardless of the read, just to show people I can play, I'm healthy, and I can take a hit.
So it's third and one. Keaton had to be carried off on a stretcher in that game against Hawaii, which was the turning point game for the Aggies. They were down 21 points at halftime, came back to win that game, have not lost since. Third and one. Turbin with the carry and shuffles through, first down and more. Now the cut back to the 40, to midfield. Robert Turbin into Ohio territory. And a big run for Turbin, 28 yards, Utah State first down.
You know, that Gary Anderson talked to, you're going back to Chucky Keaton for a second, that he might be more scared than Chucky was about getting back in the game. It's just when you see something like that happen, I think there's a real concern about how you play that kind of guy.
So Turbin with his best carry, and Keaton. Could have been a one-snap series for Chucky Keaton, but with that run and the handoff in the big game, he stays in. He gives it to Turbin here, who couldn't quite squirt through this time. Got about a yard on that first down rush.
And we don't know the extent of Adam Kennedy's injury, which we maybe will find out later, but and he seems to be, no, they're going to keep Chucky Keaton in the game.
And we're getting word from that Utah State sideline. Adam Kennedy never received any medical attention, so he came out, but he didn't have to go to the bench. The trainers weren't working on him. But we have another injury, and it's the umpire, Johnny Hippett, was banged up, and they're giving him an extra moment to make sure he's okay.
Those guys are in the thick of it. You know, they don't wear any pads, and a lot of times they get run into, and they try to get out of the way and try to keep their eyes focused on what they're supposed to be responsible for on the field, and they can get some bad collisions sometimes.
Now Johnny's going to stay in the game, tough it out.
See what happens to him right here. Oh.
So I think right as that play was ending, here's a handoff left side and hit out of bounds. Smith, no flag. I think Utah State wanted the penalty there for the late hit. Instead, it's Gerald Moore who's down. We've got an injury of play now.
Well, the contact, they lay off the contact once he gets out of bounds.
That was a good no call. 6 yard carry though, and Gerald Moore took the worst of it. Now he's down, but he is already on the sideline.
It's a physical game, and I'll tell you, when the temperature drops too, those things hurt just a little bit more. It's not easy to stay loose when it's very, very cold.
Kerwin Williams in the backfield, and Chucky Keaton still in as the quarterback, has to use
first time out of the half. 30-second timeout.
First timeout for Utah State.
see this at the sideline. You know, sometimes the track gets slippery too at that area. And yeah, he actually slips and falls and sort of probably bruised his tailbone just a little bit right there. That's a hard collision with a very cold, firm track.
Now, the injury to the Utah State quarterback, although Adam Kennedy looks like he can come back in the game, is available, but they're sticking with the freshman, Chucky Keaton. Dave Baldwin, the offensive coordinator, part of that huddle. Third down at 3, Utah State into Ohio territory. The ball at the Bobcats 40.
One thing they said about Chucky Keaton, he's a very vocal, very energetic leader, whereas Adam Kennedy's sort of a laid-back, very, you know, cool guy, different personalities out there on the field.
Both effective, but very different leaders for this Aggies offense. Option play, the pitch, and a good catch on the pitch, but Kerwin Williams going backwards, and he's going to lose a bunch of yards. In fact, he lost 8 on that third down play. Utah State is lucky that wasn't a turnover.
Yeah, and that's the one thing both teams have avoided so far today, and that's really crucial because both of these teams are negative for turnover ratio on the season. But tonight, neither one has given up a turnover.
The punter, Tyler Bennett, out for the Aggies. Their drive stalls across midfield. Both Clark and Carey are back to receive this punt. And it's Clark who makes the catch at the 6, no fair catch, and then pays the price for that. He moves the ball forward by a few yards, 41-yard punt, and a 4-yard return. Final 17 seconds here of the third quarter. Utah State with 2 big plays on the ground early in the third quarter, but Ohio answered with a touchdown. This is just a 6-point lead for the Aggies.
And Ohio's put themselves in a situation where with this drive, they can take the lead. They're less than a touchdown down, which is sort of exciting at this point in the game. They got to feel really good.
Being outgained in total yardage by plenty, but the Bobcats on the scoreboard only trail by 6. Tough field position, though, for Ohio from the 9. Pistol formation. Here's Harden from Tettleton. Harden. Nice run outside the 15 and falls forward near the 19. Got 9 on first down.
Great job. And Harden is not the biggest back we talked about earlier. He's only 185 pounds or so, but he does a great job of finding those creases and seams in the defense.
End of the third quarter, 15 minutes to go. Utah State with a 23-17 lead. From Boise, the famous Idaho Potato Bowl on the campus of Boise State. Start of the fourth quarter. And Utah State, the Aggies with the lead. And the Aggies, a little different approach at the end of the third quarter than Ohio.
Yeah, Michael Smith heads up that huddle over there for Utah State. And a guy that's not very vocal talks. And when he talks, they listen.
What a tradition that has developed over this year for the full team huddle led by Smith, who's having a huge game himself. And part of the reason why the Aggies have the lead, that rushing total you see there at the bottom, 301 yards on the ground for Utah State. But Ohio has the ball here, and a handoff gets the Bobcats a first down as the fourth quarter gets started.
Those rushing numbers shouldn't surprise anybody for Utah State. They're 6th in the nation in rushing, and they're going to do that. And they've sort of gone away from the pass just to focus on the run.
Why throw when you're getting 5, 6 and more yards a carry? But this is definitely still a game. Ohio with Tyler Tettleton, their outstanding sophomore, record-setting quarterback. And Tettleton gave it up the middle to Harden. Harden gets 2.5 yards on the first down carry.
I love the way Tettleton carries out fakes. He carries him out full speed, so you really have to take a second look to see if he's got the football.
I think he fooled the Ohio fans. There was a gasp as he got to the edge there, didn't have the ball. He was going to run a long way, but without the football, he keeps it this time, and Tettleton tackled from behind. Good pursuit there by Quinn Garner. But a nice gain of 7 yards for Tettleton on the ground.
And he's getting untracked, as we talked about. And that motion, that movement they just did, that speed option into the boundary is what set up the big play action pass earlier in the game for the touchdown.
Tettleton on a big third down play, third and two. Getting much louder inside Broncos Stadium. Passing, and a hit. We'll see where the spot is. Dunlop held on, and I think he got the first down. Kyle Gallagher with another big hit from the middle linebacker spot. And they will,
they're going to measure this one.
Bring out the chains and measure what will be a big ruling.
Kyle Gallagher says, don't come in my territory. And that's my area of the field. But I think he did have the first down yard. Ooh, it's pretty close from that angle. It's tough to see. We'll see what the measurement says.
Depends on that spot. So they bring the chains across. Just into the fourth quarter, Ohio trying to get a drive rolling. And the Bobcats, by a half a football, get the first down. Well, Tyler Tettleton, the sophomore from Norman, Oklahoma, the son of Mickey Tettleton, who is a two-time Major League Baseball All-Star. Tyler's chosen football, and a kid whom the Ohio coaches never saw play a game in high school. He missed his junior year with an injury, and maybe because of that was a little under-recruited. Ohio is going to look at a kicker. And Josh Heupel, coaching with Oklahoma at the time, sort of tipped him off. And the rest for Ohio has been great history, because Tettleton, as a sophomore, has set all kinds of records for the Bobcats with two more years of eligibility.
He's a great competitor. He got overlooked because he didn't have any stats, didn't play his junior year due to the ACL, but also he's only about 5'11", so he's undersized somewhat as a quarterback. The combination of the two, no stats his junior year, he was under-recruited. He's not undervalued anymore, though. They love him here.
On second down and nine, Ohio's had a much tougher time on the ground than Utah State has, that's for sure. Over the middle, Brazill hung on, got the big hit, and they'll say he's down. Well, Brazill, they're ruling it a catch and then down before the ball squirted loose. Again, it was Gallagher, who's just been a heat-seeking missile for Utah State.
Good look. That's definitely a catch. And then the ground, I think, seemed to cause it, but he recovered it anyway. So I think it'll be, I don't even think the stop play, just continue going.
7 yards short of a first down, another third down and two for Tettleton and company. 6-point lead for Utah State. On the option, the pitch to Harden. Good defense, Utah State. And no gain for Dante Harden. Bowden, the safety, came up and defended it well.
Sets up most likely a punting situation, but I guarantee you Utah State will keep their defense on the field to stop a fake. They're saying, make sure the ball is kicked. Crucial situation here.
Well, you're exactly right. They've essentially kept the base defense out there just in case. Morrison back to receive.
We call it safe punt return. You saw the coaches on the sideline signaling safe, safe, safe.
Well, Morrison with a good high punt signals fair catch and comes all the way back to about the 11. To make that fair catch signal. 11:23 to go from Boise. Utah State 23, Ohio 17. LaVon Brazill and the Ohio Bobcats have had to play from behind for basically this entire game. They trail by 6 with 11:23 to go from Boise. The Famous Idaho Potato Bowl, as bowl season's just getting started here today, and we've had a good one on a chilly night. Feels a lot colder than 41 degrees, that's for sure. And back at quarterback, Adam Kennedy for Utah State gives it to Turbin, who gets to the corner there and gets a nice gain. We'll go back to the studio with Wendy Nix. Wendy?
Thank you very much, and we check again on College Hoops ESPN2. NC State kept it close, but the number one team in the country pulling away. Syracuse scoops Jardine with the jumper. They lead 83-68 late in this game.
Utah State would certainly like to build on this lead, give themselves a little breathing room here in the fourth quarter.
Moats goes in motion for the Aggies. Kennedy from the shotgun gives it to Turbin. And Turbin diving for that first down mark. They're going to spot him, I believe, about a half a yard short. 4 yards for Robert Turbin. Brings up third down and very short for Utah State. And Turbin was headed out. Now he'll stay in the game. And that carry gets him right to 100 yards. Their second 100-yard rusher of the night.
Utah State right on the football, waiting. They were going to run it. If they were going to let him run the play, they were going to run the quick play at the line of scrimmage. Officials wouldn't do it. They wanted to measure it.
So they had signaled short, but then they took another look and say, we'll stretch the chain out and measure. And for Utah State, good thing they did, because they had the first down.
He sort of bounced along the field. I know he lunged. Let's see where he's down. Yeah, actually, it's where the ball is when he is down. So I think he actually got this, because right there, and he's across that marker. Great job.
A good extra effort from Turbin. Offensive player of the year from the WAC. Michael Smith, who's had a career game already with 154 yards and two touchdowns. He's alone in the backfield. And they'll give the ball to Smith. Much more modest carry as Gerald Moore's helmet pops off. And a penalty flag is thrown. First flag in a while.
Yeah, there's some rocking and socking. When you see helmets bouncing along the field, that's some great collisions. Also, when you have two backs over 100 yards.
Offside, 45 on the defense. 5 yard penalty, first down.
When you have two backs that get over 100 yards, usually you are going to win the football game.
So the offside penalty there. Lorenzo Fisher, a defensive back, lined up offsides, which is not really supposed to happen.
He's probably in press coverage, just didn't realize where the line of scrimmage was.
First and five. Kerwin Williams moves back into the backfield. Turbin is there as well. Kennedy keeps it, pitches to Williams. First down and more to midfield. Williams. And he almost stayed on his feet there, tackled at the 45 of the Bobcats, 28 yards.
And this is the changeup that Williams brings to the table. You run the speed option, got the fake inside, and you're in the quarterback. Adam Kennedy, nice job of just pitching out there and then off to the races. Kerwin, one of the best backs in the speed back. He's the guy they love to get in the open field, whether it's returning kicks, punts, or carrying the ball.
And I like, Mike, what you had said earlier in the game. As Williams gets to 57 yards, the ball skills of Kennedy, the quarterback, to hide that fake and let the defense bite on it. Now he does give it up the middle. Williams for a shorter gain of a couple of yards.
I think early on in the season, they were very concerned about whether Adam Kennedy could run this offense at this level. He ran it at the junior college level, but he's not the niftiest athlete. He's a bigger, taller guy with probably a better arm. But I think his development, as we talked about, in the read zone, spread option stuff, has been something the coaches have been very, very pleased with.
Second and eight for the Aggies. The clock continues to move, under 9 minutes to go. Moats in motion. Kennedy to Williams, left side running, tackled near the 40. Well, this week on Monday Night Football, great matchup. Frank Gore and the 49ers continue their postseason tune-up, hosting the Steelers, who are fighting themselves for playoff position. Steelers-Niners on ESPN's Monday Night Football at 8:30 Eastern. Also available live on Watch ESPN.
Jim Harbaugh doing a great job with the 49ers, just as he did at Stanford.
Now the 49ers have made a dramatic improvement. College coach going to the NFL with big-time success. Third and five for the Aggies. Kennedy pressured, gets away from the rush, looking downfield, and his throw is incomplete, out of bounds. Turbin couldn't get free. So another drive stalls for Utah State, and the punt team comes back on the field.
Kennedy has surprising escapability. He's got what I call bumps on the back. You see him feel that rusher coming over the top. He steps up. He buys time to throw the ball away. Still had to throw it away, but that's a better decision than taking the sack.
It's interesting, when he's bought time and avoided the rush, he has not turned that into big plays. Tettleton, the Ohio quarterback, several different times in this game, has extended the play and really made something of it.
It's the difference in their foot speed, in all honesty.
Fair catch at the 9-yard line. Ohio gets the ball back. A one-score game when we come back to Boise.
ESPN College Football, the Famous Idaho Potato Bowl, is brought to you by the Idaho Potato Commission, Audi, Truth in Engineering, and Dove Men Plus Care.
Holiday time here in Boise, Ohio. Poor starting field position, but down by just six as they begin this drive. Dante Harton wrestled out of bounds. Short gain on first and 10. Here's what these two teams are playing for, the trophy. Very appropriate, I think, here in Idaho.
I wonder if those are already cooked, baked, or whatever. Live a long time. Potatoes are good food for you.
Doesn't look like it to me, but I'm not quite as expert as the folks up here in Boise are. Getting creative with the potato sack costumes. Tettleton, looked like a design keep play, and Tettleton avoids another big hit from Gallagher. But a gain of five, an immediate third down play here for Ohio. The clock is not their friend. They're only down six, but under 7:20 to go.
And depending on how it goes, they may only get one more series based on the ability of Utah State to run the football. We talk about four-minute offense when you're ahead is designed to take 4 minutes off the clock. Ohio's got to score on this drive.
Third and four for the Bobcats. Utah State fans making a lot of noise now. Tettleton, the play clock down to three. Flushed out to his right with a flag already down. Tettleton will be pushed out of bounds and then goes over that little small wall, cushion padded wall, and appears to be okay. I hope that lady on the sideline is okay as well. That was a little scary, but Tettleton's fine. We'll see what the flag is. Could be offsides against the Aggies.
I'm thinking it might have been. I think he may have thought he had a free play there. Either it was motion or it was offsides.
Offside, 55 on the defense. Penalty 5 yards. Results in a first down.
There you see Tettle on the sideline. You're trying to get up over the wall. Didn't quite make it. I think it's getting a little slippery out there in terms of when you get off the field.
Yeah, he didn't have the footing. I think he can probably hurdle his way over that if he...
Yeah, no, I'm sure he can.
...has a little more of a advance warning, but Tettleton's fine. And that's a big penalty against Utah State. First down, Ohio. First and 10 from the 20. Pistol formation. Tettleton looking to pass. On the move, gets rid of it, and throws it away.
Similar play to what they had scored the touchdown earlier. Big play, fake the speed option, really pulls the defense up, and nobody came open. Great job by the secondary of staying home, and great pressure from Utah State's defensive line.
Tough guy game here in Boise, and Gary Anderson, head coach of the Aggies, trying to lean on his tough guys on the defensive side.
Well, this defense has given up a few leads this year, but they've won five in a row, and I think they've gotten over that.
Harden up the middle. Harden fighting for that first down, and I think he has it right out to the 30. Cade Brady with the tackle, but 10 yards for Dante Harden and a first down, Ohio.
Come back to this. This is a very key drive for Ohio. They've got to score here. They're down less 6 points, the reality is. But if they drive down and don't get a score, take a couple minutes off the clock, Utah State, with that pounding ground game that they have, can really take a lot of time off the clock.
Second and, or first down rather, for Ohio from the 30. Tettleton, kind of a botched play, trying to make something of it, but Bobby Wagner was there to tackle him behind the line of scrimmage, and now he's hurt and goes down. Tyler Tettleton, one of many players who've been banged up in this game.
I think he's more frustrated right now about the snap being off, and he is dinged up a little bit, but he's trying to talk to his center about the snap count. It's so important in the spread when you're in back away from center, shotgun formation, that snap, the timing and the accuracy of the snap.
He's staying in the game, under 5.5 to play, second and long. Tettleton again has to scramble, throws, and he's got the pass complete across the 30, out near the 34-yard line is tight end Jordan Thompson with the catch for 5 yards.
Sets up a difficult long third down, but Ohio's been very good this year, almost 50% on third down conversions for the year.
Utah State fans, they realize this is a big play in this game. Third and 6 for the Bobcats. LaVon Brazill, the big play receiver, wide to the left. Four receiver formation. Tettleton from the shotgun. Pressure from Gallagher. He gets away, throws, and it's incomplete. Intended for Dante Foster with some contact, but no flag. And Frank Solich is unhappy about that.
A lot of hand fighting between the receiver and the defender. So I'm actually surprised the flag didn't come out. Tettleton buys time and gets popped a little bit there. Not enough to cause a flag to go. But you see downfield here, the receiver's right there. You're just battling. Both are pushing off. I'm not sure. I think they thought it was even for both. Tettleton certainly wanted the flag, though. No question about it.
He was arguing, but he lost the argument, and so the punt team out with Morrison to receive for Utah State. This time the punt bounces inside the 30, still bouncing on the blue turf inside the 10. It'll wobble its way down to the 7. Well, Tettleton trying to hang in this game. So are his Bobcats. Utah State with the 6-point lead.
Mrs. Claus.
Well, look who stopped by Boise. I think those two would qualify as VIPs here at the Famous Idaho Potato Bowl. Final 4+ minutes, and the Ohio fans hoping their defense can come up with a stop and quickly against the Aggies, who lead 23-17, 4:23 to go. Hand off to Turbin, and keying on the run, a good tackle. Turbin gets back to the line of scrimmage.
One of the things, every offense has what they call a four-minute offense. This is designed when you're ahead in the game to take 4 minutes, and now we can say they want it to be 4 minutes and 7 seconds of offense, but you got to get that first down, keep the clock moving.
Under 4 minutes now. Ohio does have a couple of timeouts remaining in this one. You figure the Aggies want to get that play clock down as much as possible. Kennedy being patient as he comes under center. And the clock down to 4. He stumbles, keeps his balance somehow, but still tackled for a 2-yard loss back to the 5.
One of the things when you mix under center and shotgun, sometimes the quarterback gets stepped on, like right happened right there. The center steps back or gets pressure hard, and the quarterback hasn't pulled his feet out of there yet. Luckily, he hung on to the football. I thought the ball was going to come out right there.
Well, it's third down and 12. Utah State 9 of 16 on third down. So they've been real good on third down in this game. But you wonder from the 5 how aggressive they're going to be.
Well, they're going to let this clock run down pretty far.
Under 3 minutes to play. Play clock all the way down to 1. And they'll burn a timeout to avoid the penalty. So timeout Utah State trying to hang on in Boise. They lead by 6. Final 2 minutes, 54 seconds from Boise. 23-17 lead for Utah State. When this game is over, live coverage of the trophy ceremony will be available on ESPN3. Ohio down by 6, trying to get the ball back. Third and 12 for Utah State from their own 5. And they keep the ball on the ground. Michael Smith, who's had a huge second half, not this time. Another tackle for Noah Keller. 4-yard carry, and Tyler Tettleton will get ready to come back in this game because Utah State is going to have to punt, and pressure on the special teams here.
Fairly conservative approach by Gary Anderson, but he's going to put this game on special teams and his defense to keep them out. Ohio should get great field position based on punting out of your own end zone. The ball should be at midfield or better. So watch out, guys. We got a heck of a game here.
And for the first time, the big play guy, banged up but still dynamic, LaVon Brazill is the punt returner. The punt is off. Brazill has to go back inside the 45 and tries to get away from the first man, but gang tackled after that. It's going to be good field position, but good special teams play by Utah State. Not as good as it could have been. But Ohio with the ball and 2:02 left. Capital One Bowl Week on Tuesday on ESPN. Florida International and Marshall, it's the Beef O'Grady's Bowl. St. Petersburg, Capital One Bowl Week on ESPN. ESPN Radio, ESPN3, and also live online at watchESPN.com.
That was a great punt and great punt coverage when they needed it. Thought the ball would have been probably at the 50. That extra 12 yards or so just makes it that much more difficult.
49-yard punt and a loss on the return. So Tettleton, the quarterback, looking for some heroics. And a first play pass complete into Utah State territory. Riley Dunlop for 18 yards. And here come the Bobcats.
And there's plenty of heroics left in that Ohio team. They've got two timeouts. They've got plenty of time. They don't want to leave too much time on the clock when they take the lead.
Down by six, though. They won't get picky if they can get into the end zone and have an extra point to go ahead. Hand off Harden, right side. Dante Harden takes a hit, but a nice gain inside the 35. Down to the Utah State 34-yard line, 8 yards for Harden. And quick tempo here for the Bobcats, 1:23 to go.
This is what they do best. They feel good in this quick tempo, up-tempo stuff.
Still two timeouts for Ohio as well. Tettleton in position. Harden sprints out. Tettleton pressured. Tyler Tettleton gets a block, gets to the corner, to the 20, inside the 20, and goes out of bounds at about the 18-yard line. And I think it was the wide receiver Dovell who put the block on that helped Tettleton get that 16-yard gain.
Great job of awareness of him, get to the edge, and then nice job athletically of cutting up the field. That's a great athlete. He can run full speed laterally and then make that cut at the sideline.
A great block by Dovell on the big hitter, Kyle Gallagher. So now Ohio inside the red zone. Final minute plus, down by six. Tettleton throws for the end zone, and it's incomplete. Intended for Dovell. Both games used to tight games, late finishes. The four losses for the Bobcats by a total of 15 points this year.
Both of these teams, as you've talked about, are used to winning and losing close games. It's something that they just tend to find a way to keep it close, I think.
They blew a huge lead in the MAC championship a couple of weeks ago against Northern Illinois, trying to come back from a big deficit here tonight in Boise. Second and 10. The throw out to Harden. Harden getting to the edge to the 15, stays in bounds. No, he stepped out at about the 11.5-yard line, did get seven, and did get out of bounds, so the clock stops with 52 seconds to go.
Remember, Ohio going for their first bowl victory ever, first 10-win season since 1968. Could have had a face mask right there, but that's where his toe steps out of bounds.
Yeah, that might have been a missed call there if that face mask penalty would have made it first and goal. Instead, it's third and three. Four down territory for the Bobcats. They need to get into the end zone. A field goal doesn't do them any good. Tettleton rolling to his right, looking toward the end zone. Tettleton trying to run out of bounds and well short. In fact, he lost a couple of yards. And it is going to come down to this play. 45 seconds to go. Fourth down for Ohio.
This is difficult for both teams because Ohio can get the first down. You have to decide on at Utah in terms of pass coverage. Am I playing to stop the first down or stop the touchdown? So I would assume you'll have multiple levels of receivers to one some at the first down marker, some in the end zone.
And a timeout, Ohio, just to get organized. Their season is on the line here. Fourth and six coming up. First, let's check in our studio with Wendy Nix.
Thank you very much. Just coming up in about 15 minutes or so, Ladarius Green and Louisiana Lafayette getting set to face San Diego State. It's the Arnell Carriers New Orleans Bowl. T-minus 15 minutes and counting.
Well, way back early in this game, Ohio stopped Utah State's offense on fourth and goal from the one. Here we are at the very end of this famous Idaho Potato Bowl and a dramatic setup. It's fourth down and six, this time for the Bobcat offense. They need to convert here down by six.
Yeah, we talked about the fact that there will be multiple level receivers. There'll be several receivers at the first down marker. There'll be a couple receivers going into the end zone for a quick look to get the quick score to give them the chance to win this football game.
They were 8 out of 12, Ohio was, on the year on fourth down. Tettleton, the sophomore quarterback. Fourth and six.
Single receiver at the top. Take a look at the single receiver at the top.
Here comes some pressure up the middle. The lob, throw, caught, Brazill! And he lunges for the goal line. No signal yet, touchdown! Ohio! And LaVon Brazill.
I think they'll take a look at this. I think he might have been down before the ball crossed. You see it on the replay here. He just throws it up right there. Great job of getting the football. Ah, yeah, he's down. He doesn't quite break it. It's going to be probably set at about the half-yard line, maybe foot line.
But even if it is overturned, if they take the touchdown off the board, it's still a first down, and it's first and goal for Ohio.
It is first and goal for Ohio, but they got a chance for Utah State to keep them out. They still have to score. This is different, but it'll be down there. Oh, my gosh.
Well, they will take a look, and it is hard to determine. We get a lot of great replay looks from our camera crew, but unless you have that direct line right on the goal line, it can be hard
Rolling
to tell.
Rolling on the field is a completed catch. It was fourth down. The player caught the pass, ball in the zone. He is the only one that can get the ball. We'll have to bring the ball back to the half-yard line where it fumbled. The previous play is on the further review.
Well,
I think that said what we thought, right? That the ball will be downed most likely at the half yard line.
Well, they're going to
take a
look.
Although if he fumbled it, and he fumbled it in his own and got it himself, it's a touchdown.
This is an Ohio team that in its football history has never won a bowl game. LaVon Brazill is one of the great players they've ever had, has come up with two enormous plays here in the second half. That one may have tied the game with an extra point and a chance for Ohio to go ahead, but they're taking a look upstairs.
He's going to get my vote for the best player in this game. That is an amazing play, and he was single covered. He just took it and said there. Now, that is down. He has not crossed the plane. The ground caused the fumble. I think the ball will be back at the half-yard line.
And it's about as close as it can be if it's not in.
And it does give Utah State still the chance to keep them out. Gosh.
Well, you can never take it for granted, right, that you get in. I mean, no. I'm sure Ohio's thinking they'd like this touchdown to stand. We'll see if we can take a different look. Almost straight down that goal line as he hits the ground. Well, I think you're right, Mike, but the question is,
to overrule what they did on the field.
That's it. You got to be able to actually overturn the call. So they're taking several looks upstairs. An SEC crew that has done an excellent job here tonight.
It doesn't look to me as if that ball broke the plane. I think he was down. The ball was out. I don't even think it's a half a foot. I think it might be the 3-inch mark or something like that. But as you said, Dave, they have to see something that will overturn what was already called on the field.
Here we go.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed.
Well, now here's where Ohio is celebrating, but I'm not sure that our head referee, Penn Wagers, during his explanation of the replay review, the one official had ruled a touchdown, but I think after they talked about it, they're going to spot the ball inside the one-yard line, and so the ruling is actually confirmed, and Frank Solich is now only finally understanding. Gary Anderson still, I don't think, knows what's going on.
You're absolutely correct. I don't know that was presented very well. I think the ball has been placed at the 3-inch line, where the he was down. It is first and goal from that point with 37 seconds left in the game.
So the ruling on the field was a touchdown, but not after they talked about it. So the official ruling was no touchdown, and that's what was confirmed on the video review. The mass chaos on both sides, and I think the players are still trying to figure out exactly what the ruling is here. Right at the end of this game, it's obviously a critical moment, and we're going to get a further explanation.
There's a correction on the play. The receiver who recovered the ball, I mean fumbled the ball into the end zone, was the player who ended up getting the ball in the end zone. Therefore, it is a touchdown.
So, after all that, it's a touchdown. And I really do not understand that at all. It looked to me like it wasn't a fumble in the first place, but
if the ground can't cause a fumble, then that's a mistake. Somebody.
And it looked like his hip was
he
down
has
anyway.
Control. He puts the ball down on the ground. The ball is down. Should be down. That's unfortunate.
But the ruling is a touchdown for LaVon Brazill. And so after all that, here comes an extra point that has to be executed by Ohio. It's still tied with 37 seconds left. And the Bobcats, who have had so much disappointment in their history, have never had a bowl victory. And they're not even going to kick the extra point. They're still going to come back and talk about it.
Well,
it's a long jog over
I'll
to the headset.
What, this is a heck of a deal. And you're right. We're still just a tied ball game at this point. So the added emphasis on special teams. It's an amazing game. That's why the bounce of the ball.
You know, Mike, I wonder if the replay officials were confused about what they should have been looking for, which could impact the decision of confirmed overturn. And maybe they want to talk further about what the original call was down on the field.
Well, I will come back to this. He is down. He placed the ball down. He had control. It's not a fumble. The ground cannot cause a fumble in that situation. That ball should be down, in my opinion, at about the 3-inch line when his hip landed down and where the ball was at that point. He controls the ball. Ball is down, comes out after contact with the ground. He does recover it in the end zone.
After further review, replay has reviewed the ball. The boy who caught the pass was down at the 6-inch line prior to fumbling the ball. That is the ruling. The ball is placed at the 6-inch line. First down.
So, in essence, after all of that, I think the call, in essence, was overturned. The ruling on the field different from what the replay officials saw, which is kind of what you saw originally, Mike. First down and goal, Ohio, at the 6-inch line with still 37 seconds to go. And Brazill and company have to come back on the field, and they still are down by 6. They still have to punch it in.
Instant replay is there to get it right. I think it took a long time, but they did get it right.
I agree. So, and they're still not ready for play yet. A team, Ohio, that has struggled in the red zone. They only need 6 inches here. And even in this spot, they don't put Tettleton under center.
Well, but he'll still run it. This quarterback sneak just comes from the backfield.
So Tettleton keeping it himself, pushing forward, and he did not get there. Second and goal coming up, the clock rolling. Ohio has that one timeout, and they'll use it, which I tell you what, puts a whole lot of pressure on this very next play. And it's amazing how these final 40 seconds have played out. Gary Anderson knows his Aggies still have a shot here.
It's a great job of piling up by that Utah State defense, entire defense, not just the defensive line. That's a lot of bodies in there, but they created. You got to go up over the top sometimes. When guys go low, you got to launch yourself. 20 seconds left, no timeouts for Ohio. They can probably get 2 plays without timeouts. It depends if they throw the ball. They can run it. They could, if they run the ball, they're probably only going to have 2 plays. If they throw it, they could probably get 3 plays, because 6 to 8 seconds down here to throw the ball. They're going to take shots in the end zone, and I would think that's what they may do on this next down, see if they get a one-on-one matchup to the outside and just throw it up
for the guy who's made every play tonight so far when they need it, LaVon Brazill.
Dave Fleming, Mike Bellotti here. Mike, longtime head coach and a very successful one at Oregon. Mike, if you're Frank Solich on the sideline, are you calling a couple different plays in case you have to hustle if the first one doesn't work?
If you call a running play, yes, you have to have two plays called. If it's a pass play, you don't.
So here we go. Final 20 seconds from Boise. Still a six-point lead for the Aggies. Second and goal. Brazill motions into a tight formation. Low snap. Tettleton faked the run. Now he's going to go for the end zone. Tettleton dives. Touchdown, Ohio. And now it's tied with the extra point to put the Bobcats ahead.
And that was a broken play. That was not designed. He was going to try to throw over the middle on play action. Step forward, slip. And as he did that, he saw that the outside edge was open. Tremendous athleticism and effort to keep his balance and get in the end zone.
So here we go. Matt Weller for the extra point try. The hold, the kick is up, and it's good. 13 seconds to go, and Ohio 13 seconds away from their first ever bowl victory.
See right here, he steps up inside, slips and falls, and the defenders on the outside got caved in, slipped and fell down. Tettleton diving into that end zone. Very, very happy young man right now. And so is Frank Solich. Even though he doesn't show it a great deal. That's an old coach right there. That is, I'm not sure he's figured it. He says, okay, that's all right. You know, sometimes winning is merely relief.
And what a contrast for Ohio. You got to feel good for the Bobcats and a tough moment for Utah State. But Ohio, the extreme disappointment of a couple of weeks ago in the MAC championship game when they had the big lead and looked like they were headed for a conference title, blew that lead, lost to Northern Illinois, and almost an exact turnaround here tonight in Boise where they were down by 13 points well into the second half. They have come from behind and taken the one-point lead.
Dave, you're so right. And both of these teams, we talked about how much they had to play for. Both of them wanted this game. And Ohio, just so disappointed in that MAC championship game. And so close after you said, having the lead and then giving it up. But they've come back tonight, 13 seconds away from victory.
Now, all that replay confusion and chaos did allow almost 25 seconds to move off the clock between the original ruling of touchdown and the actual go-ahead score, which even lessens Utah State's chances. They will kick it off deep here, and Jacobs takes it in the end zone. He's bringing it out with time ticking off. Jacobs gets to the 25 and is tackled there. The clock will stop with 6 seconds remaining and probably just one more play for the Aggies.
And this type of play will be what we refer to as barnyard football. Every team practices the last play of a game when you're behind. And typically it involves laterals, cross-field passes, trying to get the ball, rugby-style play. So watch out, and you'll see Ohio spread out and try to cover the entire field, get the safeties back 30 or 40 yards. All you have to do is tackle them inbounds. Game is over.
Still 6 seconds before the full-on celebration, but the Bobcats can feel it. Ohio 6 seconds away from their first bowl victory in program history. One more heave for Adam Kennedy and company coming up. Kennedy looks short middle. Turbin with the catch, and Turbin's going to pitch it back. It'll be picked up by Morrison. Ball is still alive. Coming back across the middle of the field, Van Leeuwen. Van Leeuwen still on his feet. Van Leeuwen pitches it back. Kennedy now looking to get to the edge. Adam Kennedy throws it way backwards for nobody in particular. Ohio comes up with it, and a crazy finish all the way around. And now the Bobcats can celebrate. 24-23 final. Ohio gets the victory. I'm sure Gary Anderson can't believe it. The head coaches with a nice handshake near midfield. But Frank Solich's Bobcats with the first bowl victory in the history of The Ohio football program, the 2011 Famous Idaho Potato Bowl champions from the MAC.
Those are great victories and difficult losses right there.
No
kidding.
Both
sides of the spectrum.
And a tough one for the Aggies to take. Frank Solich, the victorious head coach, is downstairs with our Heather Cox. Heather?
Thanks so much. Coach, congratulations. First bowl win in school history in dramatic fashion. When that touchdown was denied and then you had to score on that final possession, how much was your adrenaline pumping?
Well, it was an amazing ending to the game, and I think both sidelines were having a lot of adrenaline going. It was a different game, and but, you know, and we've made plays in the second half when we had to, and getting that final touchdown was unbelievable for our school. That's tremendous.
And such a gutsy performance it seemed from LaVon Brazill, who might not have even played today because he had... I'm going to keep your coach warm for a few more minutes. There's a big Gatorade bath right behind you, Coach. I busted the surprise. You're welcome, by the
Thank
way,
you
Coach.
Thank you very much.
Talking about Brazil's effort, not even knowing whether he was going to play with that torn meniscus.
Tremendous. You know, he also has a bone bruise along with the little tear, and so... he didn't practice at all leading up to this game. He warmed up, felt like he could go, and then came out with a great performance.
Coach, congratulations. Duck and cover, all right?
Yeah, you got it. Thank you.
Well, Heather, Frank Solich might owe you one, although he still got a pretty cold bath there, at least part of it. And Tyler Tettleton down celebrating himself, our Capital One player of the game, and he sure deserves it. 251 total yards, but doesn't really tell the full story. Led the comeback, Ohio, with their first ever bowl victory here in Boise at the Famous Idaho Potato Bowl. They came from 13 back in the second half, and the Bobcats get the win against Utah State. 24-23 is the final. Coming up next, the R&L Carriers New Orleans Bowl. From down in the Big Easy, this has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader.